The Death of Oakland Baseball, A History of A's Ownership. Hello, my name is Stephen Layton, and I'm going to be discussing the death of baseball in Oakland and what led to it. I'm hoping to shine light on what really led to John Fisher and the A's current attempt to abandon Oakland for Las Vegas. Discussions related to the A's relocation saga make it very apparent there are quite a few common misconceptions out there. This video will attempt to correct the narrative and tell the true story of what really transpired and led to the current state of things. The atmosphere at Oakland A's games is unlike any other, as there is truly a sense of family and community amongst A's fans. No one is louder and prouder than Oakland fans, and there's no other fan base like us. We also take much pride in our beloved city, as the town is one of the most diverse and unique cities in the country. It would be an absolute crime to rip this team away from our fan base and our city. There is far too much blame placed on A's fans in the city of Oakland for the A's potential relocation, and the reality is, neither us fans nor the city deserve any of that. My hope is that this video will help demonstrate that ownership has been the problem all along. Part 1. A's Ownership from 1901 to 1995. Before we dive into what led to the A's current relocation saga, it is important to know some of the team's ownership history. I will try to be as brief as possible here. The A's came into existence as an American League charter team back in 1901, playing in Philadelphia. The team was managed by future Hall of Famer Connie Mack, a former player. The A's had success early on, winning 3 World Series titles in their first 14 years as a team. The success didn't last long, as the team ran into financial struggles during World War I, and the A's had some historically bad teams due to the core from the earlier teams having been sold off. Mack was a part owner of the team by this point and would eventually become full owner, but he didn't have the financial resources that some of the other owners of the era had. The team did not recover financially until the late 1920s, as the A's became a juggernaut once again, winning their World Series in 1929 and 1930. It wasn't long until Mack once again encountered financial issues, and the core was sold off again just a few years later. The A's would struggle financially and on the field until after the end of World War II. They enjoyed a few winning seasons in the late 1940s, but still struggled financially, and this continued into the 1950s. By 1953, the A's, now being run by Mack's sons, Roy and Earl Mack, were close to bankruptcy. After a dismal 1954 season, owners around the league and the league itself wanted the A's to be sold to someone else. The Yankees lobbied hard for the A's to be sold to Arnold Johnson, who owned both Yankee Stadium and Blue Stadium in Kansas City, which was home to the Yankees AAA team. Roy and Earl Mack did not want the team relocated, but with pressure from the Yankees and the team circling the drain financially, they eventually agreed to the sale. There was an attempt to keep the A's in Philadelphia by selling them to Philadelphia car dealer John Criscione, but the deal fell apart in the 11th hour due to unfounded rumors, reportedly started by the Yankees, that Criscione couldn't afford the deal. Immediately after an agreement was struck between the Macks and Johnson, Johnson requested to relocate the team to Kansas City, and after a close vote, the relocation was approved by the other owners. Despite losing the A's, Philadelphia did at least still have the Phillies, who had preceded the A's in Philadelphia by 18 years, so at least Philadelphia residents weren't without a team. Due to a conflict of interest, Johnson had to sell Yankee Stadium back to the Yankees, and he sold Blue Stadium to the city of Kansas City, who renamed it Municipal Stadium. There were rumors that Johnson was going to take advantage of an escape clause in his lease of Municipal Stadium, which allowed the A's to leave after 3 years if attendance fell below 1 million, and these rumors also suggested that Johnson would relocate the team to Los Angeles. After the Dodgers relocated to Los Angeles in 1958, Johnson's plan was ruined. Under Johnson, the A's were not competitive in any way in Kansas City, and this, along with the relocation rumors, caused attendance to suffer greatly as a result. During Johnson's ownership of the team, there were impossible to ignore rumors that Johnson was in collusion with the Yankees. There was a good deal of evidence, too, as the A's made quite a few trades with the Yankees in which the Yankees received significant returns and the A's barely received anything of value on their end. Due to this, the A's were often referred to as the Yankees farm team. In spring training of 1960, Johnson suffered a fatal stroke. Later that year, his estate sold the team to businessman Charlie Finley. Finley swore to never move the team from Kansas City. The team did begin to improve a little under Finley, but most of his efforts were focused on trying to relocate the team, despite his earlier promise. Less than a year after buying the team, it was reported that he was interested in relocating them to Dallas. A bit later, he was focused on Louisville and Atlanta, Then his focus shifted to Denver and San Diego before once again shifting his focus to Milwaukee, New Orleans, and Seattle. None of these attempts were successful, but not long after these failed attempts, he struck a deal to move the team to Oakland, which they moved to in 1968. Kansas City residents were understandably sad and frustrated to see their team go, but the A's relocation was contingent on Kansas City getting an expansion team in 1969, thanks in part to Missouri Senator Stuart Symington threatening to use legislation to break baseball's antitrust exemption. The A's lack of success in all the years Johnson and Finley spent trying to relocate the team had also rubbed a lot of people the wrong way, so there were tons of people in Kansas City who preferred getting an expansion team. Kansas City did receive their expansion team, the Royals, who were much more popular due to them being original to Kansas City. Meanwhile, Finley promised that Oakland's new team would remain there. It didn't take long for the A's to have success in Oakland, as they won five straight division titles from 1971 to 1975, and won three straight World Series titles from 1972 to 1974, arguably one of baseball's greatest dynasties. Despite their success, Finley was not very popular as an owner. He constantly and publicly was at war with his players, managers, and other owners. Starting as early as 1970, just 2 years after moving to Oakland and promising to stay, he began romancing potential buyers in an attempt to move the A's to either Denver, Seattle, or Toronto, while at the same time letting go of employees, slashing budgets, and cutting back on ticket plans and promotions to bolster his arguments the franchise was struggling financially. As he was doing all of this, he went on national television to criticize Oakland for not supporting the A's enough. In July 1975, Commissioner Bowie Kuhn announced that the Bay Area was not a two-team market, and either the A's or the Giants would have to leave by the end of his term. It wasn't long after that statement when the Giants almost relocated to Toronto, as Giants owner Horace Stoneham agreed to sell the team to a Toronto-based ownership group, but were saved by San Francisco Mayor George Moscone, who won an injunction to stop the sale and convinced Bob Lurie to buy the team, who ironically would nearly cost San Francisco the Giants 15 years later. Meanwhile, with the A's, free agency was looming, and Finley sold off the majority of the dynasty's core because he wasn't going to pay any of them to re-sign. His fire sale was so significant that Bowie Kuhn voided two of Finley's trades in the best interests of baseball. Finley ended up taking Kuhn to court over this, but eventually lost. After 1976, nearly the entirety of the core had been traded or left during free agency, and the A's performance understandably suffered, causing attendance to suffer as well, which already hadn't been great due to Finley's already rocky relationship with A's fans. By the end of the decade, the A's become a laughingstock thanks to Finley's actions. In 1978, A's players were so fed up with Finley that they asked the league to step in and rescue them, as Finley was selling off players to pay off his debts in divorce proceedings. In both 1978 and 1979, Finley attempted to sell the team to Marvin Davis, who planned on relocating the team to Denver. The 1978 deal fell through, and in 1979, the City of Oakland and Alameda County blocked the deal by refusing the A's to exit their lease. Also in 1979, Finley tried to sell the team to Eddie DeBartolo Sr., who planned on moving the team to New Orleans. The Coliseum lease once again blocked the sale. The attempted relocations of the A's this year, coupled with a 54-108 record, had caused attendance to plummet worse than ever before. A's fans were fed up and let it be known. In 1980, Finley once again tried to sell the team to Marvin Davis, who still planned to relocate the team to Denver, but the City of Oakland once again denied the A's breaking their lease prematurely, leading Finley to finally giving up his quest to move the team out of the state, and he eventually sold the team to Levi Strauss CEO Walter Haas Jr. The Haas era is perhaps the only time in the A's entire history where the team had a good owner. Right off the bat, Haas demonstrated that he cared about both A's fans, Oakland, and the Bay Area. This was a first for A's fans after they'd been treated so poorly by Finley. Haas was a noted philanthropist and he established the first community affairs department, which is something all MLB teams have now. He genuinely cared about the fans and the community, and the A's became a great source of pride for the community during this time. In 1985, Haas and the Oakland Coliseum Commission worked out loan terms for improvements for the stadium that would include skyboxes, seating reconfiguration, and scoreboard improvements, and these renovations were completed in 1986. Haas also was very invested in the team, and unlike any A's owner before him or any A's owner after him, he spent money on the payroll and wasn't afraid if it was going to limit his profit. He truly wanted the team to be competitive. For four straight seasons, from 1989 to 1992, the A's finished top five in payroll and even led all of MLB in payroll in 1991. His investments paid off as the A's boasted numerous seasons with winning records and playoff appearances during his time as owner from 1980 to 1995. Most notable were the A's teams from the late 80s and early 90s who won three consecutive AL pennants from 1988 to 1990 and won the World Series in 1989. The A's had a handful of baseball's best players on their team and the product on the field was great to watch. Attendance skyrocketed under Haas as the A's were consistently near the top of the AL in attendance for several years, drawing well over 2 million fans each year from 1988 to 1993, including nearly 3 million in 1990. Overall, things were great for the A's under Haas. One event did occur during his ownership that will become relevant later on, so I will cover it here. In 1992, San Francisco Giants owner Bob Lurie was attempting to sell the Giants to an ownership group that would relocate the Giants to Tampa Bay. At the same time, local ownership groups emerged with hopes of keeping the Giants in San Francisco. This group was led by former Safeway CEO Peter McGowan and current Giants owner Charles B. Johnson, but there were other local businessmen who participated in the effort as well. Among those was Gap founder Donald Fisher, whose family joined in on the efforts thanks to the insistence of his son, future A's owner John Fisher, who begged his father to get involved. MLB blocked the Giants from relocating, with the owners rejecting the sale to the Tampa group and forced Lurie to sell to a local ownership group. Donald Fisher and John Fisher were part of that group. To help sweeten the deal for the Giants to stay in San Francisco, Walter Haas gave the Giants territorial rights to San Jose. As many of you probably already know, this will come into play later. Part 2, The Schott and Hoffman Years. Before starting this section, I want to thank Garth Kimball of Baseball Oakland for providing most of this information for Part 2 and Part 3. He spent a lot of work creating a timeline of A's ownership from 1995 to 2016, with sources included for every fact. There is a link to the timeline in the description. Without a doubt, the current downfall of the A's started when real estate developers Steve Schott and Ken Hoffman purchased the A's from an ailing Walter Haas, who would pass away shortly after the sale was agreed to. Haas, who vowed to only sell the team to a local ownership group, sold the team well below market price with the stipulation the new owners keep the team in Oakland. Also at the time, the Coliseum was under construction to accommodate the return of the Raiders. It goes without saying all parties involved would regret these upgrades as it turned a beautiful stadium into one of the worst in sports. Immediately after purchasing the team, Schott and Hoffman negotiated changes in their operating agreement with the Oakland Coliseum, giving them the chance to relocate to a new city with only a year's notice starting in 1998. Oakland and county officials tried to please the new owners by agreeing to pay $11 million to Schott and Hoffman and up to $20 million in baseball-related stadium improvements over the life of the lease. In Schott's first interview as owner, he refused to commit to Oakland and said the team would slash payroll. He also spoke very negatively of A's stars Ricky Henderson, Terry Steinbach, and Mark McGwire. These comments immediately led to the A's new ownership group to be very unpopular in Oakland. True to their word, they fired Lon Simmons, the A's popular and long-tenured play-by-play announcer, and they let future Hall of Fame manager Tony La Russa leave to become manager of the Cardinals. Not long after, Ed Alvarez, Schott's longtime friend, was hired as team president and was asked right away by Schott to look for ways to move the A's out of Oakland. Additionally, they let Ricky Henderson leave as they were looking for any way to reduce salary costs, and Dennis Eckersley was traded shortly after as well. In total, the A's let go of 10 veterans during the offseason. By this point, not even a year into ownership, the A's were already viewed as a joke. Hearing all the criticism, Schott fired back and said he was disturbed that people thought his agenda was to move the A's out of Oakland. By September 1996, many A's fans had opted not to renew their season tickets, and in a survey amongst these fans, the uncertainty of the team remaining in Oakland was one of the main reasons given. Schott still refused to commit to staying in Oakland, and attendance continued to worsen. In January 1998, Schott and Hoffman demanded $48 million from Oakland for lost revenue due to changes made to the Coliseum, despite the fact that the revenue loss likely stemmed from the fact that they let go of all their all-star players and failed to commit to Oakland, leading to a significant decrease in attendance. Around this time in 1998, the A's were very publicly courting San Jose as a future home. That same year, they also commissioned a study on the viability of moving the A's to Las Vegas. Also that year, a developer whom A's fans are very familiar with, future A's owner Lou Wolf, called for moving the A's out of Oakland. He believed San Jose was the only city that the A's should focus their efforts on. Additionally, in 1998, Ed Alvarez was replaced by Michael Crowley as A's president. Alvarez would go on to file a lawsuit against Schott. By the end of 1998, with the team still struggling and the majority of the fan base very unhappy, and without any real progress made towards relocating the team, it was announced that Schott and Hoffman wanted to sell the team. Oakland and Alameda County officials spent most of 1999 working with MLB to find a suitable buyer. An East Bay ownership group quickly emerged that had the backing of Oakland and Alameda County, led by former A's executive Andy Dolich and grocery store magnate Robert Piccinini, who had offered to buy the team. They were very committed to building the A's a new ballpark in Oakland and had plans to build a new ballpark next to the Coliseum. Oakland, the A's, and MLB reached an agreement that led to Game Plan LLC being hired as a consultant to recommend a new A's ownership group. Dolich and Piccinini were expected to be chosen, but in the 11th hour, a second group was added by Game Plan LLC, and the group was headed by MLB Commissioner Bud Selig's friend and neighbor, Steve Stone, and banker Lyle Campbell. Oakland Mayor Jerry Brown and other Oakland officials went to Cooperstown, New York, to support the potential ownership group of Dolich and Piccinini at the owners' meetings. Unfortunately for A's fans everywhere, MLB owners voted to table the vote on whether to approve the sale to the Dolich and Piccinini group, which effectively killed the sale. It was during this time when Selig was quoted as saying during a phone call that putting two teams in that market was one of the worst mistakes in baseball history. It was apparent Selig and MLB owners would not allow a sale that would lead to the team staying in Oakland. A's fans and Oakland officials were understandably outraged over these developments. Piccinini said in an interview a decade later that he believed Selig and Lou Wolf colluded to stop the sale so that Wolf could buy the A's. He also claimed that Giants also likely played a role, as a Giants executive once told him, "I hear you're getting involved with the Padres. We want you in San Diego, we just didn't want you here." A few weeks before opening night in 2001, Santa Clara supervisors voted to talk with the A's and set aside city-owned land for a new A's ballpark, which Schott said was a prime spot for a ballpark. Less than a month later, Santa Clara announced plans for an A's ballpark. In June of that same year, Peter Gammons reported that Schott and Hoffman were willing to fold the A's into the Angels and move them to Anaheim. This started to raise concerns that contraction of the A's might be possible. That same month, Bud Selig insulted Oakland in a TV interview saying this:
"I watched 32 years ago the Kansas City A's move to Oakland. They hurt the Giants badly. They never really did very well themselves. It was a horrible mistake."
Selig once again shows his preference for the Giants being the only team in the Bay Area market. The mention that the A's never really did well themselves was a straight-up lie, as the A's had won four titles in Oakland and were second to only the Yankees in terms of World Series titles and playoff appearances since the move to Oakland. Also that same year, Oakland and Alameda County hired ballpark architects to study ballpark locations in Oakland and other cities within Alameda County. Seven sites were studied, with Oakland's Uptown site being the most preferred, while the Howard Terminal site also landed in the top three. The Uptown site ended up being sold by Mayor Jerry Brown to developers to build affordable housing, and this transaction was reported by some that Brown killed the A's chance of a stadium, but that is a common misconception. It was true that some had a vision for an A's stadium there, especially city manager Robert Bob. However, the A's did not show any interest in the site. In fact, no one from the A's bothered to show up to the city council meeting where the study's results were presented. Brown also mentioned the Howard Terminal site as a possibility, but the A's refused to comment on any of the sites that were presented. The A's still expressed zero interest in remaining in Oakland. Around this time, the A's were on the rise, as they were on the verge of their third straight winning season and second straight playoff appearance. Attendance was also on the rise. Despite this, Schott decided to announce that he wanted to move the team to Santa Clara. Shortly after, Santa Clara City Council members voted to pursue an agreement to build a ballpark for the A's in Santa Clara, but there was still speculation that the Giants would fight them over territorial rights. In August, it was reported that A's GM Billy Beane was part of an ownership group headed by Mandalay Sports Entertainment, who was founded and run by future Warriors owner Peter Gruber, that had attempted to purchase the A's franchise a few weeks prior. Robert Piccinini was also a member of this potential ownership group. MLB said no to the sale and said they would rather contract the A's than see them sold. When this came out, it led Santa Clara to suspend their ballpark talks with the A's, as they were upset that the A's were almost sold to the Los Angeles-based Mandalay Sports Group. Later that month, the A's agreed to terms with first-round pick Jeremy Bonderman, whose signing had been delayed due to Schott balking at the signing bonus, saying he didn't want to give $1.5 million to someone who couldn't read or write, which was incredibly insulting to Bonderman, who has dyslexia. When asked about Oakland's renewed efforts to work with Schott on a new ballpark, Schott said, Oakland needs to cut a $400 million check for a new stadium. After the 2001 season, the A's lost former MVP Jason Giambi to the Yankees. Giambi was reportedly close to re-signing with the A's, but Schott refused to honor Giambi's request of a no-trade clause, which killed a deal that was reportedly at the one-yard line. During the 2002 ALDS, the A's had the highest ticket prices. When asked why they were so expensive, Schott used the opportunity to insult A's fans. Fast forward to 2003 during spring training, Schott said the A's wouldn't even make an offer to reigning MVP Miguel Tejada because the A's didn't want to insult him. Tejada, who had been vocal about staying in Oakland, was upset with the comments and it upset a number of his teammates as well. In April 2003, Lou Wolf was hired as vice president of venue development. In September 2003, Schott said the team would offer Tejada a contract. Billy Beane immediately responded by saying it was very unlikely. Despite all this, Tejada remained insistent he wanted to remain in Oakland. In late October, the A's chose not to renew the contract of award-winning announcer Greg Papa, who had been a TV announcer with the A's for 14 years. Monetary issues were cited as the reasoning for his departure. A little over a month later, Tejada officially left, signing a six-year deal with the Baltimore Orioles. In spring training in 2004, Schott once again threatened to move the A's out of Oakland unless he got a new stadium, despite the fact he was making zero effort in trying to get such a stadium. In May of that year, Bud Selig visited the Coliseum for the first time since 1989 and declared, "The A's simply can't continue playing here," and questioned the viability of Oakland's demographics. Later that month, Selig once again suggested the A's should never have moved to the Bay Area, citing that it caused issues for the Giants. In September, Schott once again said the A's should be allowed to move to San Jose. After the 2004 season, the A's traded aces Tim Hudson and Mark Mulder, breaking up the big three of Hudson, Mulder, and Zito. Meanwhile, other groups were attempting to buy the A's, only to be shot down by Bud Selig. One group featured current Golden State Warriors owner, Joe Lacob, who still to this day has a desire and standing offer to buy the A's and build them a new ballpark in Oakland. Lacob said the deal was so close that he thought it was done, but Selig did not allow the sale to happen. Another group included Reggie Jackson, former A's player and Baseball Hall of Famer. Jackson's group consisted of Bill Gates, Paul Allen, and John McCaw. His group was willing to offer $25 million more than any other potential buyer. Hoffman had already agreed to the purchase, and Bud Selig promised he'd help Jackson ensure the sale would happen, but Jackson would be hit with a surprise a short time later when it was announced that the A's agreed to sell, but it was to a different ownership group. Selig had blocked another ownership group once again, and it was the fourth known time that he had blocked the sale of the A's between 1999 and 2005. However, it's believed that more ownership groups attempted to buy the A's during that time as well, and were undoubtedly also blocked by Selig. Jackson was ready to pursue legal action against MLB, but was informed that he would lose his job with the Yankees and would never be hired by anyone in MLB again if he went forward with it. As 2005 rolled in, Schott and Hoffman finally agreed to sell the team. This sale would drastically increase Lou Wolf's involvement in the team, as he became managing partner and owner of the team along with John Fisher, who was behind the majority of the financing, as Fisher became majority owner of the A's. They purchased the team for $180 million. Fisher had to sell his share of the Giants to become owner of the A's. It's crucial to mention that Wolf was an old friend and also a roommate of Bud Selig in college, and it is widely believed Selig prevented any purchase of the A's until his buddy Wolf got an ownership group together, and that Wolf had been handpicked by Selig to take over the A's, not just due to Wolf and Selig's connections with one another, but also due to Wolf's desire to move the team out of Oakland. A's fans were happy to see the end of Schott and Hoffman, but little did they know, things would get much worse under the new owners. Part 3. Lou Wolf and John Fisher. No one knew exactly what to expect with Wolf and Fisher now at the helm, but many expected they would at least be an improvement over Schott and Hoffman. The first thing Wolf did as owner was provide false hope. He vowed the team would not move to San Jose, despite the fact that he had been advocating for the move for nearly an entire decade prior. He said that he would honor the Giants' territorial rights and insisted they were going to see the situation in Oakland through, even suggesting building on the current Coliseum site. The San Jose rumors still remain, though. In February 2005, Oakland Councilman Dick Spees offered to build business and community support for building a stadium in Oakland, but Wolf rejected it, saying the new owners would do it themselves. In March of 2005, Santa Clara County's Assessor Larry Stone suggested Wolf could demonstrate that he tried to make a deal in Oakland, and then say that they have to look elsewhere, and that the only place that could be was San Jose. Wolf reaffirmed that he was not interested in moving the team to the South Bay, and insisted on building the stadium in the current Coliseum parking lot. Days later, Wolf said he would never test the Giants' territorial rights. Days after this, Wolf promised the A's will play in Oakland for many seasons. In August of 2005, Wolf announced his plan to build a stadium on the 66th Avenue to High Street site in East Oakland, which would have required buying out and or relocating 80-plus tenants and businesses from hundreds of acres in East Oakland, which may have also required the use of eminent domain. The site was near both Fruitvale and Coliseum BART stations, but Wolf demanded a BART station be built next to the site. It goes without saying, these were enormous asks, and the choosing of this site and the demands that came along with it were no doubt intentional, knowing that these asks would be too unrealistic for Oakland to agree to. Despite the unrealistic demands, members of Oakland City Council still reacted favorably to Wolf's pitch. Minutes after Wolf presented his ballpark pitch, Fremont Mayor Bob Wasserman approached Wolf and asked him about moving to Fremont instead. Wolf was very receptive to the idea. In December, Wolf was interviewed by the San Jose Mercury News, stating he had been tirelessly trying to move the team to San Jose. This came just months after he had announced his Oakland plan and less than a year after his comments about having no intention of moving the A's to San Jose. All of this came while Wolf had already begun talks with Fremont. At the end of the 2005 season, Wolf and Fisher decided to tarp off the third deck of the Coliseum, while simultaneously raising the prices of second deck tickets to $20 a seat. These two moves eliminated nearly all inexpensive tickets. By lowering the capacity and raising prices, it made it almost impossible for the A's to draw 2 million fans per season. This allowed the team to claim there was a lack of fan support and eliminated any sharing of concession revenue with the City of Oakland. At the time, the lease agreement stated that A's must share concession revenue with the city anytime attendance reached 2 million. In March 2006, Wolf announced that he was looking at Fremont as the ballpark site, saying Oakland has too many other priorities besides a new A's stadium. A month later, Wolf expressed he wanted the site of the ballpark to be chosen by the end of the season. Meanwhile, Wolf was negotiating for a 3-year extension of the Coliseum's lease, trying to demonstrate a sign of good faith. An MLB insider stated of this, "He has to show he's tried to make a go in Oakland. If then he makes an effort to make a go in Fremont, then Wolf can go to the commissioner and say, okay, now let me go." During the summer of 2006, mayoral candidate Ron Delms approached Wolf and asked him how they can keep the A's in Oakland. Wolf responded with, "Don't break your pick on this." In October 2006, during the A's locker room celebration after winning the ALDS, announcer Ray Fossey said, "Looks like you are going to have your parade." Wolf responded with, "We just have to figure out where to hold it," which alluded to that it might not be in Oakland. A month later, Wolf, A's officials, Selig, and Cisco CEO John Chambers announced that the A's will build a new ballpark in Fremont at a rural site that is 5 miles from the nearest BART station. All of a sudden, the demand for the BART station was no longer necessary. Wolf stated that the team would either be called the San Jose A's of Fremont or the Silicon Valley A's of Fremont. The next month, Zito, the final and only remaining member of the Big Three, signed with the Giants. 2007 began another cycle of the A's selling off their stars, and this period continued gradually all the way through the 2011 season. Notable players that would be traded during this period included Jason Kendall, Milton Bradley, Dan Herron, Nick Swisher, Mark Kotze, Rich Harden, Joe Blanton, Houston Street, Carlos Gonzalez, Matt Holliday, Rajay Davis, Mark Ellis, Brad Ziegler, Andrew Bailey, Trevor Cahill, and Gio Gonzalez. In June 2007, Wolf admitted that it would be business as usual if the A's got a new ballpark, saying that they are very bottom-line oriented, suggesting the A's would not shed their frugality even if they got a new ballpark. Later that year, in October, Wolf reaffirmed that Oakland was not an option and said fans should be happy that the team was going to at least be staying in the Bay. In a September 2008 Q&A at an Athletics Booster Club meeting, Wolf claimed that he spent 2 years making a sincere effort in Oakland, despite all the evidence to the contrary. In March of 2009, citing opposition from Fremont residents and business leaders, Wolf said the Fremont ballpark plan was dead. Oakland Mayor Ron Delms immediately reached out to Wolf after the Fremont ballpark failed, but Wolf rebuffed him and made it clear his goal was to move the A's to San Jose. U.S. Senator Barbara Boxer also sent a letter to Bud Selig in support of keeping the A's in Oakland. That same month, Delms and Oakland City Council member James Brunner sent a letter to Selig asking for his help. Selig appointed a 3-person committee to study the A's ballpark options. Also within the month, Wolf announced that he would not pursue a ballpark in Oakland. Wolf stated a short time later that Oakland is a built-up area. There aren't a lot of pieces of land that don't have a big expensive component to them to make them work. Yet a report from the same year stated that there were at least 1,200 acres of vacant, underutilized public land in Oakland. In November 2009, Wolf again announced that he wanted to move the A's to San Jose. In December 2009, Oakland announced that it was offering the A's three ballpark sites near Jack London Square. Three locations were the Victory Court site, which was 20 acres, Jack London North, which was 20 acres, and Howard Terminal, which was 51 acres. In comparison, the site in San Jose Wolf was interested in was just 14 acres. Wolf responded that he had no desire to keep the team in Oakland, and in January 2010, all his focus was on San Jose. In May 2011, the A's changed their Twitter handle from Oakland A's to Athletics, and some wondered if it was a slight against Oakland or if a San Jose deal was close. In December 2011, Bob Nightingale infamously tweeted, "All signs and top MLB sources say the Athletics will be granted permission by February to move to San Jose." February 2012 came and went, and no decision was made. 4 days before the 2012 home opener, Wolf insulted A's fans in the city of Oakland, saying that he doubts Oakland can come up with a credible plan, just drawing some lines on a few blocks doesn't get you a stadium. He also added that there are not enough A's fans in Oakland to justify keeping them there. It should be pointed out that in 2005, at the very beginning of Wolf and Fisher's ownership, attendance was 2.1 million. Attendance began to fall rapidly once it became apparent what kind of owners Wolf and Fisher were. In August of 2012, Oakland met with C-League's three-person committee, pitching the 51-acre Howard Terminal waterfront ballpark site next to Jack London Square. Wolf said he was not interested in the site, saying, "We have analyzed Howard Terminal upside down and sideways, and that it has no ability to be implemented for a ballpark." The statement here makes one wonder about the A's intentions with choosing this location 5 years later. In June 2013, San Jose sued MLB for the right to move the A's there, challenging the Giants' claim to the South Bay and MLB's antitrust exemption. Wolf claimed he wasn't aware of the lawsuit. In September, Wolf complained again about the attendance at A's home games, despite the fact that he and Fisher were directly responsible for the lack of attendance. On October 4, 2013, the same day of Game 1 of the ALDS, A's president Mike Crowley gave an interview about the team's failure to sign a Coliseum lease extension and implied that the A's may leave after the season if they can't finalize a deal. That same day, it was revealed that the reason Wolf and Fisher raised parking prices was to pay a parking tax the Coliseum JPA had begun to enforce. The parking hike generated nearly $3 million for Wolf and Fisher, and instead of paying what they owed to Oakland and the Coliseum JPA, they decided to pocket the money for themselves. Wolf and Fisher had become deadbeat tenants. In December 2013, Clorox CEO Don Noss, Mayor Gene Kwan, and other Oakland business leaders announced they were preparing the Howard Terminal site for a new 30,000-seat ballpark for the A's. Wolf said that it'd be easier to build on Treasure Island. Howard Terminal would be as close to impossible as anything, and that he wanted nothing to do with the idea. Noss and company said that they were inviting Wolf to build there, but if he didn't want to, they would put together an A's ownership group who would. Later that day, Wolf said the only site he'd consider in Oakland is the existing Coliseum site. In February 2014, A's president Mike Crowley let everyone know once again he doesn't think much of the Coliseum and they haven't been able to explore the market due to the territorial rights issue. A month later, Wolf announced he was evaluating the viability of building a temporary ballpark somewhere in the Bay Area if the A's weren't granted a longer lease at the Coliseum. Wolf also hinted and threatened looking outside the Bay Area market. Amid the lease negotiations, Wolf once again met with San Jose. In June 2014, Wolf reiterated he had no interest in Howard Terminal and only the Coliseum site if the A's chose to stay in Oakland at all. Bud Selig said he was fully supportive of the team's view that the Coliseum was the best site in Oakland. Around this time, Oakland drafted and adopted a new master plan with a certified environmental impact report for the Coliseum site, which to this day would allow three separate major league sport facilities to be built on the Coliseum complex. Also in June, the A's finalized a 10-year lease extension with the Coliseum. This severely impeded the Oakland Raiders from possibly building it at the Coliseum site to build a stadium, something the Raiders had been seeking and something they had been in discussions with Oakland officials about. Raiders owner Mark Davis said that he was unable to make a deal because the A's never made a declaration with what they wanted to do. As we all know, this is one of the biggest reasons the Raiders relocated to Las Vegas. Mark Davis has always held firm that the A's were one of the main factors. In October 2014, Wolf told Forbes magazine that his philosophy is money first, baseball second, saying, "We wouldn't feel good if we were winning games and losing money." In November, local Oakland businesses began to call on owners to sell the team to a group that would commit to Oakland. At the same time, Wolf was asked about other viable sites in Oakland besides the Coliseum, and Wolf said there were absolutely none, and Wolf was focused on the team moving to San Jose. After the 2014 season came and went, the A's were coming off three straight playoff appearances. They had even reached 2 million fans that year, as attendance had been on the rise again due to the A's success. In November, the A's signed former Royals DH Billy Butler to a 3-year, $30 million contract. This contract to this day is still the largest contract the A's have given out under John Fisher's ownership of the team. That same day, Josh Donaldson, the A's all-star third baseman, replied to a Twitter comment in which someone had referred to the A's owners as not having as much money as the other owners. Donaldson said, "They have plenty of money, my friend. They just tell everyone they don't." 10 days later, Donaldson was traded to the Blue Jays in what many baseball fans regard as one of the worst trades of all time. Despite having 4 years of club control remaining, the A's shipped Donaldson off for a mediocre MLB player and three prospects, none of whom ever helped the A's in any significant way. There was a lot of speculation that both his Twitter comment and his rocky relationship with A's GM Billy Beane led to the trade. The A's had a fire sale that offseason, trading other established players such as Brandon Moss, Derek Norris, John Jaso, and Jeff Samardzija, and letting everyone go once again in free agency, including John Lester and Jed Lowrie. A's fans were getting tired of seeing the same cycle repeat over and over. In February 2015, Guy Saperstein, an A's minority owner, posted on Facebook that the A's owners' public and well-known position is that they prefer to move to San Jose. After years of proposing on Ballpark Village, Wolf then said he only wants surface parking surrounding the ballpark, and despite the Coliseum area having hundreds of available acres, Wolf said it wasn't enough to retain sufficient parking surface for a ballpark. It was at the same point where Wolf shot down the Stadium City idea, which the Raiders had also been interested in. Again, the A's did not attempt to work with the Raiders in any way whatsoever. Field of Schemes blogger Neil DeMaus called out Wolf for his flip-flopping on the Coliseum site and mentioned that his newest statement contradicted his own statement from 2010, where he said the only way the Coliseum site would work is if there were ancillary development surrounding the ballpark. On October 5, 2015, the U.S. Supreme Court ended San Jose's bid for the A's by refusing to hear the city's claim that MLB used illegal monopoly power to block the team's relocation. This decision was the final nail in the coffin for Wolf and Fisher's San Jose dream. On the field in 2015, the A's had their worst season since 1995, thanks to the A's gutting their roster. Attendance plummeted. In 2016, the A's only improved by one game and attendance continued to plummet, and the front office continued to run things on a shoestring budget, something that had been a common theme in Oakland for 21 years now, despite the A's having been on revenue sharing for years. Of course, the point of revenue sharing is to give money to small market and or poorer teams so that they can have extra money for their payroll. Of course, this never happened in Oakland, as the owners always pocketed those revenue sharing checks. Also, there had been zero activity on the A's behalf in regards to new stadium for nearly 3 years at this point. On the morning of November 17, 2016, major changes were announced. Lou Wolf was stepping down as managing partner and would be selling nearly all of his share in the team. Additionally, President Michael Crowley was stepping down as well. In their place, John Fisher, majority owner, who now owned nearly 100% of the team, was announced as the new managing partner. The new president was announced as Dave Cavill, who was the president of the San Jose Earthquakes, the MLS team that was owned by Fisher. A's fans were thrilled to see Lou Wolf leave the picture, as well as Crowley, although fans still did not have any trust in John Fisher, the reclusive owner who never gave interviews and who the majority of A's players, past and present, have never met. Despite being behind the scenes mostly, it was well understood he was largely responsible for the cheap payrolls and efforts to move the A's out of Oakland. A's fans had some optimism with Dave Cavill, as he had helped the Earthquakes secure a new stadium. There wasn't a lot of trust and ownership amongst the fanbase, but some were still hopeful that things would change for the better after these moves. Part 4. Who is John Fisher? To understand what John Fisher's intentions and motivations are, one must understand who he is and where he came from. John Joseph Fisher was born June 2, 1961 in San Francisco to Donald George Fisher and Doris Lee Feigenbaum, the third of their three children. His two older brothers are Robert Joseph Fisher, known as Bob Fisher, and William Sidney Fisher, known as Bill Fisher. John Fisher's parents, Donald and Doris Fisher, had founded the clothing company, The Gap, Inc., also known as The Gap or Gap. Gap is one of the largest clothing manufacturers in the world, and they also own Old Navy, Banana Republic, and Athleta. Due to this, John Fisher and his brothers inherited immense wealth. John Fisher's net worth alone is $2.5 billion. They've never had to do a real day of work in their entire lives. It should also be noted that Donald and Doris Fisher came from wealth themselves. They had a lot of money to put into Gap thanks to being born into wealth. Donald and Doris's parents, grandparents, and great-grandparents all came from money. These families were involved in real estate, contracting, and manufacturing. While some were suppliers, merchants, or had their own law practices, some were even involved in state politics, and nearly all of them owned their own companies. They were all born into money. No one in Fisher's family has had to put in a real day of work in over 100 years. They relied on inheritance and exploiting the labor of others to grow their wealth. For these reasons, Donald and Doris Fisher founding Gap is not as impressive as it sounds. Additionally, Gap has been in hot water for using child labor not once, not twice, but 3 times. Some of the workers in these overseas sweatshops get paid pennies a day and work in very unsafe and unsanitary conditions while working extremely long hours. John, Bill, and Bob Fisher are still very involved with Gap, as the three of them own roughly 50% of the company. John Fisher is also on Gap's board of directors. As a child, John Fisher was given the nickname Harpo by his parents, as he had a habit of pestering his parents relentlessly until he got what he wanted and was incredibly stubborn. He was your typical spoiled rich kid. He grew up in San Francisco, attending Giants games with his grandfather, Sidney Fisher, and has always been a big Giants fan. He attended Phillips Exeter Academy in New Hampshire, a preparatory and private boarding school, as did his brothers. Fisher then went on to attend Princeton University. After Princeton, he worked as a fundraiser for then-President Ronald Reagan and then-Vice-President George H.W. Bush. Afterwards, he attended Stanford University. He married his wife, Laura Meyer, who came from a wealthy family herself, in 1988, and the two of them had 4 children during the 1990s. After Stanford, Fisher's parents got him a job for a real estate company that did business with his parents' company, Gap. The business failed, so his parents made him president of Pisces Inc., the Fisher family's investment management company, as well as a partner in Sansome Partners, another investment company ran by the Fishers. It was around this time in the early 1990s when he begged his dad to get involved in the Giants' potential relocation, urging his father to join in the ownership group that would keep the Giants in San Francisco, as he believed it was a civic-minded thing for him and his family to do. The Fishers became part owners of the team, and John Fisher kept his stake in ownership until he became owner of the A's. He still has, not one, but 2 luxury suites at Oracle Park, home of the Giants, despite being A's owner. He is, always has been, and always will be a Giants fan. In the late 1990s, John Fisher and his family got involved in the timber industry, cutting down tens of thousands of trees along California's northern coast. The Fishers, owners of the Mendocino Redwood Company, sparked environmental protests in 1998 after they purchased 350 square miles of timberland in Mendocino and Sonoma counties. The Fishers were clearing too many trees and not safeguarding the forest for the future, which made their family very unpopular in Northern California. This all came right after the Fishers were in the headlines for Gap using child labor. It was also in the late 1990s when John Fisher formed a relationship with his future co-owner, Lou Wolf, when he and Wolf purchased several Fairmont hotels in San Francisco. John Fisher and his family have also been very active in the privatization of schools. Fisher's parents donated more than $70 million to Kipp Charter Schools, and John Fisher has not just made hefty donations of his own, but is highly involved with Kipp as he currently serves as chairman. Fisher and his family have also made large donations to political candidates who support the privatization of schools as well. In 2006, Fisher gave $85,000 to All Children Matter, a school privatization political action group in Ohio that was slapped with a record-setting $5.2 million fine for illegally funneling contributions through out-of-state dark money networks. Instead of paying the fine, they shut down and their founder launched a new group, the Alliance for School Choice, and made Fisher their secretary. Also in 2006, Fisher angered many California residents when it was revealed he had donated $25,000 to a campaign in opposition of Prop 82, which would have made preschool free for 4-year-olds in California. Speaking of political donations, John Fisher has donated nearly $10 million to political candidates and political action committees over the last 25 years. Fisher, a Republican, has donated mostly to Republican candidates, but has made some donation to Democratic candidates as well. These donations to Democrats usually are because he has an interest in something on their platform, many times because of the candidate's involvement in the privatization of schools. He and his family also have maintained friendships and alliances with the last 3 California governors, Arnold Schwarzenegger, Jerry Brown, and Gavin Newsom. Newsom, an old family friend of the Fishers, has received hundreds of thousands in political donations from the Fishers. This may explain why the state of California is not doing anything to try and prevent the A's from leaving, as well as the state's silence on the issue. I'm sure if California's government wanted to, they could definitely complicate things for the A's, but that won't happen because of John Fisher's ties to Newsom. Bob Fisher has also held government roles under Schwarzenegger and Brown. Besides their donations to Newsom, the Fisher family has also made donations to Schwarzenegger and Brown as well. Bob Fisher is supposedly known for his environmental work, as he was on the board of Natural Resources Defense Council, an environmental advocacy group, for over 20 years, but that appears to just be for good PR considering he and his family's involvement in the timber industry. This video will for the most part leave politics out of things, but some of the donations John Fisher has made have been to far-right candidates with extremely close-minded views. For example, it came out recently that he endorsed anti-transgender Republican candidate Doug Burgum for the 2024 election. Donations such as this one really make you question Fisher's character and beliefs. In 2012, the Fisher family donated heavily in support of Prop 32, which would have severely limited the ability of organized labor and unions to raise money for state and local political races. It comes as no surprise the family who thrives on child labor is anti-union. Additionally, in 2012, it was revealed that the Fisher brothers donated $9 million towards a political action committee that opposed Barack Obama. I'm not trying to be political with this last fact, I'm just trying to demonstrate how much the Fishers are spending on political donations. In 2016, the Fisher family donated in opposition to Measure V in Mendocino County. The measure established fines and regulations for killing trees and leaving them behind, something that can increase the risk of wildfires. Fisher's family opposed this due to their logging involvement in the county. In 2022, John and Bill Fisher donated nearly $1.2 million each in opposition to Proposition 30. Proposition 30 would have increased taxes by 1.75% for those that have an income over $2 million. The measure would have funded wildfire prevention infrastructure and electric car incentives. John Fisher has also donated to Vice President Kamala Harris, which may explain why the Oakland native has been silent in regards to the A's potential relocation. Another thing John Fisher and his brothers have been involved in is replacing grass with artificial turf in San Francisco neighborhoods. This was mainly taking place in 2006, and there was a lot of opposition from local residents, as not only was the chemical odor bothering residents, but there were known cancer-causing chemicals within the plastic turf. The Fishers went to great lengths to deny this information, despite there being existing studies that prove the harmful effects these chemicals can have. The Fishers have also been known to screw over small businesses, as they once stole business from the man that taught their father how to fly fish. Jack Trout, owner of the business, had nothing good to say about the Fisher boys in his Facebook post. The Fisher family has also been more than involved with the San Francisco Museum of Modern Art, also known as the SF MoMA. Thanks to a deal the SF MoMA absolutely regrets, the Fisher family pushed the SF MoMA into building multiple floors for storage of the Fisher family art collection that they had hoarded over the years. This forced the museum to make cuts to their legacy programs. Fisher has not been a good steward to the Oakland community either, only donating $25,000 to the A's Community Fund from 2018 to 2021. Under Fisher, nepotism thrives in the A's organization as he hired his own son-in-law, Ross Bowen, for the position of Director of Project Finance for the A's. At the end of the day, the Fishers only care about one thing, increasing their wealth, even if it comes at the expense of others. Their wealth came from inheritance, not hard work, and they should not be viewed as successes. They are also in the pockets of politicians throughout California and the United States. They are not a friend of the environment, public education, nor the working class. John Fisher is nothing but a trust fund baby that only cares about padding his wallet, even if he needs to conduct unethical business dealings to do so. Part 5. John Fisher and Dave Cavill. Dave Cavill coming on board inspired hope for many A's fans. The fact that he had been able to secure a stadium for the Earthquakes led a lot of A's fans to believe he would be able to secure the A's a ballpark in Oakland. At the time, Cavill was quoted as saying, "I am enthusiastic to join the Athletics. The club pursues a world-class ballpark in Oakland for the best fans in baseball." However, not everyone was a believer in Cavill. At the time of his hiring, former Oakland A's pitcher and former A's analyst Greg Cadoret called the hiring a mistake and that it was the wrong move. He said he'd been around Cavill in the Golden Baseball League, an independent baseball league which Cavill founded and operated for several years, and that Cavill was full of hot air. He also said Cavill only cared about his own success and did not care about the fans. Little did we know, Cadoret was onto something. In January 2017, Cavill promised it was going to be a huge year for the organization, and promised a site and timeline by the end of 2017 for building a new stadium in Oakland. Cavill appeared to be eager to meet with fans, and even set up office hours in which fans could come in and chat with them. In March of 2017, the A's unveiled their Rooted in Oakland campaign, which was their first attempt to show a commitment to Oakland since Wolf's short-lived lies of early 2005. Soon after, the tarps came off the third deck and small improvements began to be made here and there throughout the Coliseum. A's fans were feeling very hopeful for the first time in a long time. In September 2017, the A's decided on the Peralta site to build a new stadium, which was across the street from Laney College. The Peralta site belonged to the college, and there was a large pushback by faculty and student groups after this announcement. This led to the Peralta board to reject the A's stadium plan in December. A common misconception I've seen is that the city rejected the site, and that simply wasn't the case. It was actually rather embarrassing for the A's, as they had only consulted with one person involved with the college before making the announcement that they had chosen the site. MLB Commissioner Rob Manfred called this an unfortunate misstep on the A's part. The A's acted very shocked and surprised by this result, but it really shouldn't have come as a surprise at all. Cavill had put on a nice act in 2017, but no real results could be shown. In 2018, the A's made some more minor improvements to the Coliseum and continued with their Rooted in Oakland campaign. Most fans were still behind Dave Cavill at this point, but some were still skeptical of him. The A's surprised a lot of people that year, winning 97 games, but the big news that year was the A's announcing the Howard Terminal site is the location of their future ballpark on November 28, 2018. This location was an interesting choice, considering all the comments made by Lou Wolf about Howard Terminal in the past, as well as the fact that in general, the A's had been against building at that site for nearly 20 years. Wolf, of course, was no longer in the picture, but it was still an interesting choice, to say the least. It was a location that would definitely present some challenges, but if done right, the A's could have a beautiful waterfront ballpark. The A's also announced the new ballpark would be open by opening day of 2023. Cavill also made promises the new ballpark would lead to the A's increasing payroll, which would lead to them to sign higher profile free agents and retain their core players such as Matt Olson and Matt Chapman. Not everyone believed these claims, however, as Cavill had made similar claims with Fisher's San Jose Earthquakes. Cavill had promised increased payroll and spending upon completion of a new stadium. Once the stadium was complete, however, the Earthquakes remained in the bottom of MLS in spending, a trend that is still continuing to this day, nearly a decade after the stadium opened. The Earthquakes are regarded as one of the cheapest teams in the league, and John Fisher is regarded as one of the worst owners in MLS. This made tons of A's fans skeptical that spending money would increase if a ballpark at Howard Terminal was indeed built. The Howard Terminal site is 55 acres, and besides the ballpark, the A's wanted ancillary development surrounding the stadium, including housing, offices, restaurants, retail, small business space, parks, and public gathering spaces. Cavill was all about the ballpark village model. The A's also said it would be privately financed, and it would take $1 billion to build the ballpark plus $12 billion in private investment for the residential and commercial space in the waterfront neighborhood. The A's sought $855 million in public funds for infrastructure and to develop the land surrounding the ballpark. To get this $855 million, the A's asked the City of Oakland and Alameda County to seek grants and use project-generated revenues to help fund it. The $855 million was split in two: on-site infrastructure, which the A's sought $495 million for, and off-site infrastructure, which the A's sought $360 million for. The $495 million would be paid to the A's using EIFD bond proceeds, which would reimburse the A's for the on-site infrastructure, parks and open space, and on-site affordable housing. The $360 million would come from federal, state, regional, and local funding for off-site infrastructure. In April 2018, the Port of Oakland commissioners had voted unanimously to enter a one-year agreement to negotiate exclusively with the A's. This agreement allowed the A's to pay the Port $100,000 to study economic feasibility and environmental, transportation, and accessibility issues. By March 2019, MLB completed an environmental impact report for the Howard Terminal proposal. On the field, the 2019 A's were just as good as the year before, and they would go on to win 97 games. Due to this, along with renewed hope for a future in Oakland, attendance increased for the third year in a row. Off the field, things were moving along with the Howard Terminal project. In May 2019, the Alameda Labor Council voted to support the A's efforts to build the ballpark. The council strongly supported it as they believed it would provide a great deal of jobs, including an estimated 2,000 jobs during construction and a great deal of permanent jobs related to the ongoing operation of the ballpark. At the same time as the A's were working with Oakland on Howard Terminal, they were also in talks to redevelop the Coliseum site. The Coliseum site was owned jointly by the City of Oakland and Alameda County. The A's wanted to buy the entire site, including Oracle Arena, the former home of the Golden State Warriors, which is now known as Oakland Arena. Alameda County's Board of Supervisors voted 5-0 in favor of entering a term sheet with the A's. The other reason the A's wanted to buy the Coliseum site was because it would give them a backup plan to Howard Terminal if the deal were to not work out. Considering the Raiders were nearly gone at this point and the Warriors were almost ready to move into their new arena, many viewed this as a much easier route to a stadium. Cavill called it an assured route to a new, privately financed stadium. By December of 2019, Alameda agreed to sell its half of the Coliseum to the A's. Back on the Howard Terminal front, progress continued. On May 13, 2019, the Board of Commissioners for the Port of Oakland voted unanimously to approve and authorize the executive director to execute the initial term sheet for a term of 4 years. In October 2019, California Governor Gavin Newsom signed two bills into law to streamline the stadium process at the state level. During that same month, the A's hosted the Tampa Bay Rays for the 2019 AL wildcard game. A's fans were feeling good coming off a 97-win season. The A's were playing in their first home playoff game since 2013. Progress was being made with Howard Terminal. And in general, fans were feeling pretty good about the future of baseball in Oakland. Unfortunately, the A's would lose the wildcard game by a score of 5-1, but a crowd of over 54,000 fans were there to cheer on the A's. As 2020 rolled around, A's fans were still feeling good, hoping for more progress with the Howard Terminal project and hoping that the A's would continue their success on the field. Unfortunately for A's fans and everyone in the world, COVID-19 had other plans. As we saw the world go into a pandemic and everything drastically change, so did the baseball season. Nearly the entire season was lost as just a 60-game season commenced in late July. The A's would go on to win the division and finally get past the first round of the playoffs, but would lose to the Houston Astros in the second round. Unfortunately, the pandemic affected things with the Howard Terminal project as well. It was reported by Ballpark Digest in May 2020 that the Howard Terminal ballpark plan may end up being delayed or even scrapped, as the COVID-19 pandemic and underlying economic uncertainty will certainly impact facility planning for the athletics. A's Vice President of Communications, Catherine Aker, stated the timeline may be adjusted due to the COVID-19 pandemic. Despite this, Oakland continued negotiations with the A's remotely. Something of significance that also happened that year was in March 2020 when the A's were sued by the Pacific Merchant Shipping Association, the Harbor Truck Association, the California Trucking Association, and Schnitzer Steel. Schnitzer Steel, who was just recently rebranded as Radius Recycling, has a neighboring facility to Howard Terminal. Schnitzer alleged the A's weren't qualified to be certified under AB 734, a California law that would expedite any legal challenge against the team over environmental concerns, because the team did not meet the January 1st, 2020 deadline for consideration. The suit eventually would be dismissed by the Alameda County Superior Court in February 2021. However, the almost year-long suit delayed the process of the team getting the ballpark cleared for construction by at least a year. This would not be the final lawsuit involving Schnitzer Steel, and an interesting connection between John Fisher and Schnitzer Steel would also be discovered, but more on that later. It should also be noted that lawsuits, delays, and opposition are not uncommon for projects like this, as the Giants faced significant opposition when building Pac-Bell Park, now known as Oracle Park, as far back as 1995, and the Warriors also faced years of opposition when building Chase Center. In June 2020, the City of Oakland, who initially was not on board with the idea of selling the A's the Coliseum site, changed course as the Oakland City Council voted nearly unanimously to move forward to begin negotiations with the A's to sell their share of the site to the A's. The reason why they had been initially against this is because they believed that Alameda's sale of the site to the A's violated the Surplus Land Act. Oakland had filed a lawsuit against Alameda County over this, but it was quickly withdrawn as MLB Commissioner Rob Manfred used the threat of relocating the A's out of Oakland. This step forward brought the A's much closer to having a very suitable backup option for a stadium, as well as their goals of redeveloping the Coliseum site. Another thing that the pandemic did was showcase that John Fisher was a truly awful person. There are three big examples of this. The first was when the A's decided to furlough many of their employees during the pandemic, which meant that they would be laid off and not receive any pay. The second thing John Fisher did was decide to stop paying minor league players during the pandemic. The A's were the only team to do this, and they got dragged through the mud so badly by the media for both the decision and furloughing the employees, they ended up deciding to pay the minor league players and offering assistance to the furloughed employees. This was only done because writers, fans, and people everywhere were tearing the A's a new one. It is important to note, John Fisher had no shortage of political donations during this period. In his eyes, it was fun to donate to extremist candidates but not pay A's employees. The third thing John Fisher did was not help out A's minor league coach Webster Garrison when he was not just in a health crisis, but a financial crisis as well. Garrison, a former A's player who spent nearly a decade in the organization during his playing days, had been a coach for the A's in the minor leagues for over 20 years. In March of 2020, he fell seriously ill with COVID and was hospitalized for over 2 months. He was on a ventilator for 2 months and suffered two strokes as well, and he faced a long road of recovery. To this day, he's still not been able to resume his career in baseball. Instead of offering to pay for Garrison's expenses, the A's instead only shared his family's GoFundMe on social media. Fans were happy to help and donate, but John Fisher not using any of his or his team's money to help someone who'd been involved with the organization for nearly 30 years really tells you the kind of person John Fisher is. Additionally, after the 2020 season, the A's let Marcus Semien and Liam Hendricks walk in free agency. Hendricks was an all-star closer for the A's and was arguably one of the best in baseball. He was also a leader in the clubhouse and very involved in the community and was well respected by everyone. He was more than interested in remaining an Athletic, but the A's never reached out to him or his agent. As for Semien, the team's shortstop, he had been with the A's for 6 years and was a Bay Area native. He'd finished third in MVP voting in 2019 and was very popular as a player as well as member of the community. The A's did make Semien an offer during free agency, but it was one that was incredibly insulting. They offered him a one-year $12.5 million deal, which was already a low offer to begin with, but what made it even more insulting is that $10 million of it would have been deferred in 10 one-year installments of $1 million each. As expected, Semien declined the offer and went on to have a monster year with the Toronto Blue Jays in which he finished top three in MVP voting once again. Letting two of their best players go after 2020 is what ultimately led the A's being just not quite good enough in 2021. The 2021 A's would go 86-76, fading quickly down the stretch and coming short of a playoff berth. Another notable thing that happened during the 2021 season was when it was revealed in June 2021 what A's minor league players were being forced to eat. An anonymous A's minor leaguer sent photos to the group Advocates for Minor Leaguers that showed food that wouldn't even be fit for a prisoner. Immediately, Dave Cavill responded and claimed that this was the result of a third-party vendor and that they had already terminated their agreement with them weeks before. Once again, though, the real news surrounding the A's was what was happening off the field. MLB was growing concerned over the supposedly slow progress Oakland was making on the Howard Terminal project, which in reality had only been slowed because of a lawsuit in the pandemic, nothing that was actually Oakland's fault, and of course, progress was still being made either way. Despite this, on May 11, 2021, MLB instructed the A's to begin exploring options to relocate the team away from Oakland. That same day, Dave Cavill commented that it was Howard Terminal or bust, implying that failure of the Howard Terminal project would lead to the A's leaving Oakland, which was infuriating, considering that the A's had been against building at that site for 17 years prior to choosing that site. Additionally, all of a sudden, both MLB and Dave Cavill both stated the Coliseum site was not viable for a new stadium. So to sum it up, MLB had always believed the site was viable, the A's had interest in building there on and off for over 15 years, Cavill said in 2018 that the Coliseum site was an assured route to a new stadium, the A's bought half the site from Alameda County in 2019, MLB threatened to relocate the A's if Oakland didn't sell their half, Oakland began negotiations with the A's to sell their half, and now all of a sudden the Coliseum site was not viable for a new stadium. Cavill would later blame rising sea levels and the outstanding debts related to the construction of Mount Davis not being settled, although Oakland denied that the outstanding debt would have impeded the A's. Fisher would add that it was not suitable for their ballpark village vision, something that the A's have gone consistently back and forth on for years. We would also find out later from ESPN's Tim McCune, who heard from several sources inside MLB that the A's intentionally swore off the site as it would help their chances with moving to Las Vegas. This has to do with convincing the relocation committee that there is no viable land anywhere in Oakland for a ballpark. This was the real reason behind it. A's fans were understandably outraged at these new developments with both Howard Terminal and the Coliseum site. Not only were most fans certain to see that Cavill was a liar, but their trust in him instantly plummeted. Additionally, A's fans began to wonder if the A's actually had even wanted to stay in Oakland at all. It's no secret that the A's few attempts prior to 2018 to stay in Oakland were half-baked and little effort was put into them by the A's. Nearly every year since 1995 was spent by the A's trying to relocate the team. Then there's the fact that the A's chose Howard Terminal, which is perhaps one of the most difficult locations to build at, a place in which the A's less than 5 years before choosing the site said it would be impossible to build a ballpark at. The A's were expected to start looking into both Las Vegas and Portland for relocation. About 2 weeks later, Cavill was in the news again, and this time it was because of a tweet of his. He tweeted out a video of himself at a Las Vegas Golden Knights playoff game with the caption, "Wow, Stanley Cup playoffs," and tagged the Golden Knights. Many A's fans were very angered by this, as the tweet was incredibly tone-deaf and showed just how quickly Cavill and Fisher jumped into bed with Vegas. And it appeared they were just as focused, if not more focused, on Vegas than figuring things out in Oakland. This also marked the end of Cavill's engagement with A's fans, as he no longer interacted with A's fans on Twitter or games after this point. Days later, Cavill said the A's were on parallel paths with both Oakland and Las Vegas in regards to getting a ballpark. Once again, A's fans were furious, and the trust A's fans had in Cavill was now down to zero. It was becoming very apparent that Cavill was nothing but a smokescreen for John Fisher's attempt to relocate the team. Cavill had played A's fans like a fiddle. Cavill had mentioned early in his A's tenure that he grew up in Cleveland and was a diehard Cleveland Browns fan and spoke of how devastated he was when they left for Baltimore. He'd said he wasn't going to let that happen in Oakland, but it appeared he was fine with doing it now. If you've ever spoken to someone who has worked with Cavill before, whether it would be with the A's, Earthquakes, or back when he operated the Golden Baseball League, they will tell you that Cavill is perhaps the fakest and most disingenuous person on the entire planet. Don't believe me? Read some of the Glassdoor reviews for the A's. Talk to those who worked with him. They'll have a lot to say, and none of it will be good. Former employees of his in the Golden Baseball League have stated that Cavill would get angry at them for accurately reporting attendance. He always wanted them to inflate the attendance so that it appeared the league was successful, which it quite obviously wasn't, considering it was struggling at the time of his departure and folded shortly afterwards. A great example of Cavill's disingenuousness is when he donated a signed copy of Ken Korak's book to a thrift store in the North Bay. The book had been signed by Korak, the A's radio play-by-play announcer, with a personal message to Cavill, expressing how excited he was to work with them and that he was excited for the future of the club. As you can see, Dave Cavill is a snake. Something else that occurred during May 2021 was the end of the Rooted in Oakland campaign and slogan. The slogan was quietly retired as it disappeared from the team websites, press releases, and from the Coliseum. It had all been a sham. At this point, fans were understandably angry. The team had one foot out the door in Oakland while they were now exploring Vegas. They had let two of the A's best players walk in free agency. The team wasn't as good as it had been the past 3 years. The A's were slipping in the standings. The A's were also doing less and less promotions. And the A's gave up on maintaining the Coliseum as it began to slowly fall into disarray. Despite what the A's and MLB want you to believe, progress was still being made on the Howard Terminal project in 2021. For starters, in July 2021, Oakland City Council approved a non-binding term sheet to continue negotiations with the A's for their new ballpark. Despite this, Cavill said the A's did not agree to those terms because it wasn't the term sheet the A's had provided. Regardless, the A's still resumed talks with the City of Oakland to work on the financial deal for the ballpark. One common theme during this process was Cavill's exaggerations. Everything that didn't go 100% in the A's favor was called a major roadblock by Cavill, and every minor thing that went right, Cavill would call a huge success on the A's part. Later, in October 2021, the Alameda County Board of Supervisors voted on a non-binding agreement to create an infrastructure financing district from property tax revenue of the future ballpark. With this agreement, Alameda County and the City of Oakland would use this tax revenue over a 45-year period to pay for infrastructure near the proposed ballpark. As the 2021 season came to a close, with the A's failing to make the playoffs, a lot of uncertainty lay ahead. Obviously, there was the uncertainty of where the A's would end up, but there were more immediate issues that lay on the horizon. For starters, the A's had a lot of free agents, and most expected the A's to let them walk, which made everyone question if the A's were going to look to rebuild once again. MLB executives told MLB insider Bob Nightingale the A's were looking to slash their payroll to as little as $50 million. A's GM David Force said the A's were willing to listen to offers for any player that was on the roster. A's fans knew it was coming, and they knew that the days were numbered for franchise cornerstones Matt Olson and Matt Chapman. Additionally, A's manager Bob Melvin left the A's for the San Diego Padres. Melvin, who is often regarded as one of baseball's best managers, had been the A's manager since 2011 and was baseball's longest tenured manager. He was still under contract, but the A's let him go to San Diego without any sort of compensation. Additionally, the A's let Starling Marte, Mark Canna, Andrew Chafin, and other top players walk during free agency. This all signaled another rebuild for the A's. The biggest baseball news at the time, though, was the impending lockout that was looming over MLB. As with any lockout, it was about the players wanting better and fairer working conditions, whilst MLB owners wanted to protect their bottom line at all costs. The lockout began December 2, 2021, and did not end until March 10, 2022. It ended up delaying the start of the season and had prevented any off-season transactions from taking place. The lockout was significant for the A's for three reasons. The first was that the Major League Baseball Players Association refused to drop their grievance against the A's, Pirates, Marlins, and Rays, something that MLB had insisted on. The grievance had been filed by the MLBPA in 2018 due to the fact that the A's and three other teams had been pocketing revenue sharing money and not spending it on the team. As mentioned before, the A's had received revenue sharing for the majority of the 2000s, but A's owners had never used that money to invest in the team, only pocketing it for themselves. Despite MLB's insistence, the MLBPA refused to drop the grievance. The second reason was that the new CBA brought the A's back onto revenue sharing, meaning the A's would get more checks from larger market teams, and John Fisher could shove that money into his pockets. The third reason, and perhaps the most significant, is that the A's would lose their revenue sharing if they did not have a binding agreement in place for a new stadium by 2024. the repercussions of this agreement would come into play in the not-so-distant future. As soon as the lockout ended, the A's wasted no time and within a matter of weeks traded Matt Chapman, Matt Olson, Chris Bassett, and Sean Manaea. These moves completely gutted the A's roster, a roster that was already severely lacking due to free agent departures. The returns on these deals drew extreme criticism from baseball writers as the A's received very underwhelming returns in all four deals. The general consensus was the A's could have received much better returns. The goal of these moves, of course, was to shed payroll. It wasn't about rebuilding. Additionally, some even believe that the A's deliberately sought paltry returns, hoping to have the on-the-field product be as terrible as possible, which would drive down attendance even more and justify the A's relocation. Speaking of A's attendance, A's fans drew criticism in 2021 for their decrease in attendance from 2019 to 2021. However, critics always forget to mention that the world was still very much in a pandemic and attendance was down significantly all across baseball. Plus, the actions of John Fisher and the A's during the pandemic made more fans reluctant to give John Fisher their hard-earned money. What dropped attendance the most, though, was the A's very publicly seeking relocation to Las Vegas. John Fisher is arguably the worst owner in all of pro sports and has wanted to relocate the team for nearly the entirety of his ownership, all while the A's play in MLB's worst stadium. Additionally, the A's have been 25th or lower in payroll in 18 out of 19 years that Fisher has owned the team. All 29 teams have outspent Fisher multiple times, and of course, the A's have routinely traded away their stars or let them walk in free agency without even making a sincere effort to keep them. A's fans had every reason in the world not to show up. While we're on the topic of attendance, the A's announced new season ticket prices in late 2021 for the 2022 season. These changes were met with extremely negative reactions as most fans saw their season ticket packages more than double. Yes, John Fisher really doubled season ticket prices and then sold off the entire core of the team. The A's also removed the A's All Access program, which many fans enjoyed as a season ticket package, as it had allowed fans discounts on food, beverages, parking, and merchandise. It was clear as day now that John Fisher and the A's didn't want fans at their games. The A's were doing anything and everything to drop attendance so they could justify relocation. It seemed like the A's were essentially following the script of the movie Major League to get this relocation to happen. Understandably, fan morale had never been lower, but A's fans continued to be loud about what was going on. As the 2022 season rolled around, attendance was just about as bad as expected and the relocation rumors began to grow louder. A's fans knew the low attendance was by design and were well aware of the root causes of it, but it didn't stop from fans from other fan bases who had little to no knowledge of the situation from poking fun at A's fans and insulting them. On the Howard Terminal front, progress continued, as Oakland City Council voted in February 2022 to certify the Environmental Impact Report for the planned Howard Terminal ballpark development. A few months later, the San Francisco Bay Conservation and Development Commission voted 23-2 to remove the port priority use from the Howard Terminal site. As the 2022 season came around, the A's were expected to perform horribly, and that's exactly what happened as the A's finished 60-102, their worst record since 1979. During the season, the A's continued to gut the roster and make more trades, including trading ace Frankie Montas to the New York Yankees. The season was a new low for most A's fans, and the ballpark experience also was greatly suffering. The A's had begun to lay off staff, which led to longer lines and tons of closed concession stands. The Coliseum was completely neglected and the ballpark began to rapidly deteriorate. Despite this all, A's kept their ticket prices high and raised prices for food, beverages, and merchandise. Fisher's plan for low attendance was going just as he'd hoped. Despite all the negativity, some A's fans still remained hopeful for a Howard Terminal ballpark. They believed that is what mattered most in 2022. The certification of the Environmental Impact Report and the port priority use being removed were all very encouraging, but a new challenge popped up. This time it was the East Oakland Stadium Alliance, known as EOSA, who sued the A's in April 2022. The lawsuit stated certain protocols were not followed with the project's Environmental Impact Report. EOSA said the A's in the City of Oakland failed to adequately disclose the negative environmental effects that the project will have on the existing waterfront. You may be wondering, who is the EOSA? Despite the EOSA claiming they are just a group of community partners trying to save blue-collar jobs in the Port of Oakland and preserving the history of the Oakland Coliseum, the group is actually a front for Schnitzer Steel and other shipping interests attempting to keep the stadium and accompanying developments away from their territory. As I'd mentioned earlier, Schnitzer Steel would be involved in another lawsuit. This was said lawsuit. It was their second attempt to try and stop Howard Terminal. The irony of the EOSA saying that they care about the environment is that Schnitzer Steel is one of the biggest polluters in all of the Bay Area. Since 2000, Schnitzer Steel has been fined 18 times for violating environmental regulations. Schnitzer Steel also has a long history of fires as well, which produce hazardous smoke that you can often smell throughout the entire county. The lawsuit ended up being unsuccessful as the Alameda County Supreme Court rejected the lawsuit in March of 2023. In total, 5 lawsuits were rejected that challenged Howard Terminal, and it was very encouraging that every attempt to stop the project had failed. Before I go any further, though, I had mentioned a while back that there was a connection between John Fisher and Schnitzer Steel. This may be of interest to those who've been following the situation, so here it is. John Fisher's wife, Laura Meyer, has an older brother who is married. I will leave out the names of this couple for their privacy. Laura Meyer's brother's wife's maiden name is Schnitzer. Upon discovering this, I did some digging and easily found that Laura Meyer's sister-in-law is the daughter of Leonard Schnitzer, who was the son of Sam Schnitzer, founder of Schnitzer Steel. Sam Schnitzer founded the company in Portland in 1906, and the company was eventually taken over by his sons, including Leonard Schnitzer. The business grew quite a bit, and Schnitzer Steel eventually had locations outside of Portland, including a location in Oakland, the same one in Oakland that was involved with suing the A's in 2020 and behind the 2022 EOSA lawsuit. Leonard Schnitzer was CEO of Schnitzer Steel from 1973 until 2003 and oversaw much of its growth. In 2010, the Schnitzer family sold most of their shares in the company. However, members of the family still occupied high-up positions as late as 2020. There is still some evidence that suggests they are still involved to some degree. Besides the fact that the former CEO of Schnitzer Steel's daughter is John Fisher's sister-in-law through marriage, the Schnitzer family has also made donations to the SF MoMA, who, as we've already mentioned, is an institution the Fisher family is extremely involved with. I don't want to speculate too much, but at the very least, it is very interesting that Fisher's sister-in-law is associated with the company suing the A's, trying to block their stadium. While unsuccessful in their attempts to stop it, they did succeed in delaying the process. Considering that some believe that Fisher never intended to see Howard Terminal through, this could be a very interesting piece of information. On the flip side, the A's have filed their own lawsuit against Schnitzer Steel, so this may just be a weird coincidence. You could really go crazy here with theories, and some of them could be true, but at the very least, this is something to think about. The last thing of significance that happened in 2022 occurred in September 2022 when the A's missed a city deadline to finalize the stadium plan, pushing negotiations to 2023. This has become routine for the A's, missing deadlines and asking for extensions, yet for some reason the narrative has always been that Oakland has moved slowly. In reality, it's always been the A's. Despite this, Manfred said that negotiations stretching into 2023 would create uncertainty, and Cavill had said that negotiations stretching into 2023 would all but doom efforts to stay in Oakland and lead to a potential relocation to Las Vegas, where the A's had already begun negotiations with city officials and local businesses about building a ballpark there. The A's were more than happy to blame Oakland, even though it was their own fault. Rob Manfred also said that MLB would waive the league's relocation fee if the A's were to move to Las Vegas. The relocation fee can range from $300 million to $1 billion, and it's money that would be split amongst MLB's owners. During the 2022 offseason, the A's continued their teardown, most notably by trading catcher Sean Murphy, who was arguably the A's best player in 2022, to the Atlanta Braves. The return package for Murphy was yet another very questionable one, one in which the A's did not receive much value. Coming into the season, things were as bleak as ever, as the future in Oakland was very uncertain and many were expecting the A's, whose payroll was now sitting around $50 million, to lose 100 games yet again. Due to the uncertainty in Oakland, the continued raising of prices, the continual teardown of the roster, and how poorly the fans have been treated, not a lot of fans were expected. The A's were primed for a historically bad season both on and off the field, but in John Fisher's eyes, everything was going according to plan. Additionally, the promotional schedule for the year was incredibly barren, the Coliseum was decaying more and more, large numbers of staff were laid off, and most basic amenities and functions of the ballpark were not even open or available for use. The layoffs got so bad that on Labor Day of the 2023 season, nearly every concession stand was closed and both entrances near the BART ramp as well as the season ticket holder's entrance was closed. Even necessities like bathrooms and drinking fountains were closed in some areas of the Coliseum. The fact that John Fisher chose Labor Day of all days to lay off a large number of staff and close up nearly every amenity the Coliseum has to offer says a lot about the kind of person he is. On the field, the A's were historically bad. At the time of me recording this video, the A's have a record of 48-110, which is already enough losses for this to be their worst season in 107 years. The only team in franchise history to have more losses was the 1916 A's, who lost 117 games, and that team is regarded by many as the worst team of the entire modern era, which dates all the way back to 1901. A's fans feel for the players and A's manager Mark Kotze, as this team was set up to intentionally fail. Meanwhile, due to Cavill and Fisher hiding from interviews, A's players and coaches have had to answer questions from reporters about the state of the team and its potential relocation, even though they have zero involvement in it. With the team being the mess that it is, fans held on to the last sliver of hope that maybe, just maybe, a Howard terminal deal would still be struck this season, and the future would still be a bright one. With negotiations continuing and more lawsuits being struck down, progress was still being made. In fact, there was more progress being made that was even publicly known about at the time, and both sides were actually growing very close to the deal, but before that was even known, a devastating announcement occurred. Late on the evening of April 19th, 2023, the A's released a statement saying that they had reached a binding agreement to buy a 49-acre site from Red Rock Casino Resort and Spa near the Las Vegas Strip where they would build their new stadium. Shortly after the news broke, Oakland Mayor Shane Tao confirmed that the negotiations for Howard Terminal were dead. Mayor Tao revealed that the City of Oakland and the A's had been meeting daily and were closer to a deal than ever before when Dave Cavill called her and informed her that the A's were purchasing a 49-acre site in Las Vegas. She said this came after no breakdown in talks and no stalling, and that things had been moving forward. In a statement, the mayor said she was deeply disappointed that the A's have chosen not to negotiate with the City of Oakland as a true partner in a way that respects the long relationship between the fans, the city, and the team. The city has gone above and beyond in our attempts to arrive at mutually beneficial terms to keep the A's in Oakland. In the last 3 months, we've made significant strides to close the deal. Yet it is clear to me that the A's have no intention of staying in Oakland and have simply been using this process to try and extract a better deal out of Las Vegas. I'm not interested in continuing to play this game. The fans and our residents deserve better. According to Mayor Tao's Chief of Staff Lee Hansen, the city and the A's had convened for a summit that month to try and iron out details to reach an agreement. To speed along negotiations, the city brought in Steve Kawa, a political advisor with ties to former San Francisco mayors, the governor's office, and a friend of the Fisher family, to act as a third-party mediator. Kawa had been working with both the City of Oakland and the A's for over a month. By the morning of the 19th, the mayor's office was feeling very confident that they'd made significant progress and had felt like they had met the A's request to accelerate negotiations. When the A's internal meeting that day ran long, Oakland realized something was going on. Cavill called Mayor Tao at about 6 p.m. and said, "Hey, just a heads up, somebody leaked to the press that we have a binding deal in Vegas." Mayor Tao, stunned, immediately reached out to Kawa, who appeared shocked, and said he hadn't been informed of the update. Kawa then reached out to John Fisher to try and figure out what was going on. Hansen said it was completely in violation of our mediation terms and our good faith bargaining efforts to go to the press and end the deal this way. Kawa encouraged John to pick up the phone and call the mayor directly. Fisher called Mayor Tao at 8 p.m. and had a short conversation. Fisher said he felt really bad, but they were going to focus all their energy on Las Vegas. Fisher asked to keep the lines of communication open, and Mayor Tao declined and wished him luck in Vegas. At a press conference the next day, Mayor Tao said, "It shows they had no interest in reaching a deal in Oakland at all." Hansen also added that Oakland felt blindsided by the A's announcement, not just because they were closer to an agreement than ever, but the A's and the City of Oakland were scheduled to have a joint press conference to inform the public if the summit had produced tangible progress or not, and if a deal was close or not. Later in this section, we will discuss the Howard Terminal financials and the affordable housing component, and we'll dispel the lies the A's have put out there about them, which are crucial to all of this. As for A's fans, those who were awake at the time of the announcement were hit with the news in a way that was akin to finding out a relative or close friend had passed away. It was shocking and it hit A's fans hard. There was a collective sense of both sorrow and anger amongst the entire fan base. Some fans held out hope that this was just a leverage play, but many feared it was the beginning of the end. As one would expect, this led to further decreased attendance, but A's fans still fought back, which is something we'll cover in Part 6. On the Vegas front, the A's were hoping to secure $500 million from the state of Nevada for their stadium project. I will now spend a bit of time discussing some issues the A's will face if they do indeed move to Nevada. It goes without saying, most Nevada residents were not happy about the A's announcement. Just years before, Nevada's government had shelled out $750 million to the Raiders for their stadium, so they weren't exactly thrilled with the idea of shelling out hundreds of millions once again for another publicly funded sports stadium, especially to someone like John Fisher, a California billionaire. Allegiant Stadium, home of the Las Vegas Raiders, is considered by many to be above average, but the Raiders' relocation from Oakland hasn't really worked out well for anyone other than Mark Davis, who saw his net worth go from less than $1 billion to $2.3 billion. Additionally, it definitely hasn't been easy for Clark County, as they have already had to pull for emergency funds from cash reserves on multiple occasions for over $27 million. This was due to tourism taking a hit during the pandemic, which led to not enough funds being generated from the hotel tax that is in place to pay for the stadium, which left Nevada taxpayers on the hook. Like Mark Davis's net worth, it is true the value of the Raiders has more than doubled since moving from Oakland, but the sole reason for that, of course, is the fact that they have a new stadium. However, it goes without saying, both the Raiders and Davis would be worth much more if they had a new stadium in the Bay Area, where the land is much more valuable. Despite the increase in value, the Raiders on the field have been mediocre at best, have been plagued by significant off-the-field issues, and are routinely invaded by opposing fans as the support in Las Vegas isn't all that strong. Most of the Raider fans that do go to Allegiant are those traveling from elsewhere, such as Los Angeles, a former home to the Raiders, which is located just 4 hours away. Raiders have always had a large fan base, and you can find Raider fans pretty much anywhere throughout the U.S., so it could have been much worse. The A's, on the other hand, have a much smaller fan base than the Raiders. There are several reasons for this, one being that football is more popular than baseball in the U.S., another being that the Raiders brand is very global, and lastly, despite Mark Davis not being a good owner, the A's are owned by perhaps the worst owner in all of pro sports, someone who has actively been trying to turn their team's own fans away for nearly two decades. Goes without saying, fan support would absolutely be lacking for the A's in Las Vegas. Most Vegas residents already have a favorite team. There are quite a few Dodger fans there, along with Angels, Padres, and Diamondbacks fans, as well as fans of other teams. There might be a lot of people in Vegas and the immediate and surrounding cities, but if you look at Las Vegas on a map, it's pretty easy to see there aren't any other large cities that are even within 2 hours of Vegas and its surrounding cities. The closest large city is St. George, Utah, which is 2 hours away and has a population of less than 100,000. As it stands, Las Vegas is in the 40th largest media market in the U.S. That would rank dead last in terms of media markets out of all 30 MLB teams. Meanwhile, Oakland is in the 10th biggest media market in the U.S. It is extremely clear that the A's would get much more support in the Bay Area, not just because of the aforementioned facts, because the A's have been in Oakland for nearly six decades. They've spent more years in Oakland now than they've spent in Philadelphia. While it is true sports teams can have some success in Vegas, like the Las Vegas Golden Knights, an NHL expansion team that began play in 2017, who had instant success and just recently won a Stanley Cup, the reason for this is because they were an expansion team. They were original to Vegas. Teams are significantly more popular when they're original to the city and not just a team that has just relocated. To find an example of that, look no further than the Raiders, who essentially play 17 road games a year. Another thing to consider is the length of schedule for these respective leagues. There are only 8 or 9 home games a year for an NFL team, so it's not as hard to fill most of the stadium for just a few games. For the NHL, there are 41 home games, which is a bit harder, but it's not a problem for the Golden Knights thanks to being an expansion team who had instant success. With baseball, there are 81 home games. Is the house going to be packed for a Tuesday night game versus the Kansas City Royals in the middle of summer in which fans had to walk in 115-degree heat to get there? Absolutely not. Additionally, even with the limited amount of home games, opposing fans flooding in, and Vegas hotels comping tickets, the Raiders are still at the bottom of the NFL in attendance, all while having the league's most expensive tickets pricing out locals. Lastly, in a city that already has the Golden Knights, the Raiders, and the Aces, who are Vegas' new WNBA team that is also owned by Davis, who also recently won a title there, it's easy to imagine the A's being Vegas' least popular team, especially when you consider the fact that the NBA will likely put an expansion team there soon and an MLS team may end up soon there as well too. The A's will be dead last in terms of priority of sports teams. Everyone will be going to any of those other games before attending an A's game. One could argue that the A's are leaning into the tourism aspect like the Raiders. However, who is going to spend the money on a trip to Las Vegas and spend 3 or 4 days going to baseball games? It is hard to imagine anyone doing that. It also goes without saying that Vegas doesn't get tens of millions of visitors each year simply because people want to go to sporting events. That's not why people go to Vegas. A's fans realized all these factors quickly, and many Vegas and Nevada residents in general have realized all of this too. Northern Nevada residents were even more frustrated with all this, as the Oakland Coliseum is actually an hour closer to Reno than Vegas is. Northern Nevadans don't want their tax dollars going towards a stadium they'd never even see. Perhaps one of the biggest criticisms in Nevada was that all this money is going to billionaire owners of sports teams, while Nevada is ranked close to last in the U.S. in education. Nevada has the biggest class sizes in the U.S., their teachers are very poorly paid, and they also have thousands of teacher vacancies. Moving back to the A's ballpark efforts in Vegas now, the A's were hoping to secure funding for their stadium before the end of the Nevada legislature session, which was set to end on June 6th. It didn't take long for the A's to change their plans, though, as on May 15th, 2023, they reached an agreement with Bally's Corp for a 30,000-seat stadium on the Tropicana Hotel site along the Las Vegas Strip. As per the agreement, Bally's would fund $175 million towards the development, and the A's would lease the ballpark. the Tropicana, a historic Las Vegas hotel, would be torn down with a new casino built in its place on the property. Bally's owns the 35-acre parcel, and they would allow the A's to build their ballpark on 9 of the 35 acres. Several things come to mind right off the bat. First off, the binding agreement apparently wasn't so binding after all. Second, the location is horrible, as there would be zero parking and traffic in that area is already known to be absolutely horrendous. It's a common occurrence for it to take hours simply to leave a parking garage in that area. Third, the A's wouldn't even own the ballpark. All this years of crying by A's ownership about needing their own ballpark, yet they wouldn't even own this one. Fourthly, the location is right near Harry Reid International Airport, so it seems like the ballpark's lights could be a potential issue if it isn't a closed-roof ballpark. Looks like there won't ever be any firework or drawn light show nights at that ballpark. Fifth, the A's would not get their precious ancillary development, something they'd been insistent about for nearly 20 years. There would be no ballpark village. The sixth and final thing is that they would only have 9 acres to build on, yet they want a retractable roof for their ballpark. That is quite literally impossible. For reference, baseball's small stadium, Target Field, home of the Minnesota Twins, sits on 8.5 acres, but it's an open-air stadium. Additionally, with just 30,000 seats, it would be baseball's smallest ballpark, but it wouldn't be small enough to fit a retractable roof on 9 acres, something that many architects agree would likely be impossible to do. By contrast, most of MLB's retractable roof ballparks sit on nearly double the amount of space, if not more. The reason a retractable roof is desired and not a domed roof is so they can still open the roof when the weather isn't bad. In Vegas, it's not so much rain or anything like that, but it's the fact that temperatures reaching nearly 120 degrees isn't unheard of in Vegas. As climate change continues, it will only get hotter in Vegas. Obviously, if there was no roof at all, nobody would go to games, nobody would want to play for the A's due to the extreme heat. To show everyone how small 9 acres is, here's an aerial view of the Coliseum site. The red triangle is the Malibu lot, which is just 9 acres. In comparison to the existing Coliseum, it's evident that it's rather small. For those watching in Vegas, here's a comparison that is more familiar to you. This is the Bellagio Fountain, which is also 9 acres. 9 acres doesn't seem like a lot of space for a ballpark, does it? I'm not sure how the A's expect to build a ballpark here, much less one with a retractable roof. Meanwhile, Dave Cavill and other A's employees are spending most of their time in Vegas trying to schmooze politicians. They were met with considerable resistance by some, as the $500 million appeared to be asking for far too much. Soon after this, the A's lowered their asking price to $400 million, which is the opposite of what they did in Oakland. It was pretty clear earlier on that the A's did not have the votes needed, but Nevada Governor Joe Lombardo, who has a history of questionable ethics, vetoing bills that would give Nevada kids free school lunches and receiving large donations from the Fertitta family, a family with known ties to the mafia, was determined to get a yes on the bill at any cost. The bill, SB 509, was introduced in Nevada's legislature on Friday, May 26, less than 2 weeks before the end of the session, with the A's now asking for $380 million in public funds. The A's were hopeful that they could cram it in and get the Nevada legislature to rush through the process and approve it. Rob Manfred and MLB were also hoping for a deal as well, as they wanted to vote on the A's relocation during the MLB owners' meetings that would take place from June 13th to June 15th. On the same day of the introduction of the bill, the A's finally released a rendering of their proposed ballpark. This rendering was immediately met with an avalanche of criticism. At first glance, it is pretty clear that very little time was spent on this. Whether they had some intern quickly put this together in 5 minutes or they just straight up used AI is not known, but it is clear a little effort went into it. In this rendering here, it looks like they just combined pre-Mount Davis Oakland Coliseum with some Howard Terminal renderings. Look at all that foul territory. There isn't a lot of detail shown, and if you zoom in closely, there are a lot of errors, such as the lack of a fence in right field. Something else that jumps out is the fact that only a portion of the roof is covered. Maybe their intention is to roast the fans alive in the Vegas heat. If it's supposed to convey a retractable roof, then that's not very clear here. It's hard to tell due to the poor quality. It's also very apparent that this thing is not even remotely close to scale, and what is this arc of light that appears to be 50 stories high? With the airport in the background, I'm pretty sure this could get you some sort of FAA fine. The funniest thing about this rendering, though, not only is it in the wrong corner of the 35-acre parcel and is also facing the wrong direction, but there is no rebuilt hotel in this rendering, which would completely block the skyline, and it shows the ballpark and its surroundings taking up all 35 acres. This rendering is absolutely ridiculous and completely dishonest. The A's were definitely hoping to trick people with this one. Later on, an A's executive said that you could wad up this rendering, which has since left the ballpark project with zero renderings. Funny enough, when the A's have made announcements in regards to Vegas, they still use this garbage rendering. Meanwhile, a public hearing for SB 509 was set for the evening of May 29th, which happened to not only be on the evening of Memorial Day, but also when a crucial game of the Stanley Cup playoffs was taking place between the Golden Knights and the Dallas Stars, where a Golden Knights win would lead to their advancement to the Stanley Cup. The A's and proponents of the bill in Nevada were hoping that Nevada residents and A's fans everywhere would be busy enough, either with their holiday or watching the game, that they would not receive as many public comments against the bill. They were wrong, though, as many callers from Nevada and California expressed their displeasure with the bill. Nevada residents pleaded for them not to give hundreds of millions to a California billionaire, while also arguing that this money should be invested in education or other areas instead, while A's fans in California attempted to warn Nevada legislatures about the kind of people John Fisher and Dave Cavill were and not to trust them. The Nevada legislature also allowed Nevada residents to give their opinions online, and as seen here, they were extremely against the bill. As June began, it was beginning to look like a vote on the stadium bill would not take place during the regular session, but the threat of a special session still loomed. The session came and went, and the bill was not voted on, which gave A's fans tons of hope and led to some celebration in the moment. A special session was called by Governor Lombardo on June 6, which gave some worry to A's fans, but it was reported that the A's bill wouldn't be heard during it. The special session came and went, but to the dismay of A's fans, another special session was called for the purpose of voting on the A's stadium bill. This session will end up taking place from June 7th to June 14th, lasting 8 days. Each day of the special session cost taxpayers $500,000 a day, so the A's cost Nevadans $4 million in those 8 days alone from their stadium bill. Since the bill was now in a special session, it was no longer with the name of SB 509, but now SB 1. With the new name came a new online public opinion poll, which once again showed that no one in Nevada wanted this. Early on, there appeared to be a lot of doubt about the A's ballpark plans. Something that was really obvious was the A's projections were complete fantasy. First off, the A's projected that the new stadium would bring in 400,000 tourists to Las Vegas each year. With 81 home games a year, that is nearly 5,000 tourists each game. That number is clearly grossly inflated, as there is 0% chance they get 5,000 tourists attending every single game. The A's also projected that 1.8 million Las Vegas locals would be in attendance. Again, another number that seems way too high. The A's also stated that they expected the ballpark to attract more than 2.5 million visitors annually. If you multiply 30,000, the number of seats the stadium will have, by 81, the number of home games, you only get a smidge over 2.4 million. So by the A statements, they project every home game to be not just sold out, but more than sold out. It's quite literally impossible, and it's completely laughable. As mentioned earlier, the Raiders, who only play 8 or 9 home games a year, and are a much more popular team in a more popular sport, are near the bottom of the NFL in terms of attendance. There's no reason to think a much less popular team in a less popular sport who play 81 home games a year would even be remotely close to selling out their games, especially in such a small market where most residents are already fans of other teams. The A's would be lucky to get 1.5 million fans annually in attendance. Attendance might not be terrible at first, but once the honeymoon phase wears off and everyone sees what kind of owner John Fisher is, it will likely be near dead last in all of baseball. Not to mention, to break even on the project, decades of sellouts are needed. It's completely laughable to think that would ever come close to happening. One argument I have seen is that the A's AAA team, the Las Vegas Aviators, sells out often. The problem with that is that the ballpark is one-third the size, and additionally, the Aviators have been dishonest with their attendance numbers. I have watched highlights and seen pictures of their games that are sold out, and the ballpark is half empty. I've seen other games where there are less than 1,000 fans in attendance, and the Aviators will claim there were over 6,000 in attendance. Recently, the Aviators' final home game of the year was said to be a sellout. Looking at these pictures and others, it's extremely hard to believe it was even remotely close to a sellout. It's obviously within the Aviators' best interest to inflate attendance numbers, as it helps strengthen Vegas' argument for either an expansion team or the A's to relocate there. Another thing that helps the Aviators in attendance is the fact that their ballpark is in Summerlin, not right on the strip, so it's a lot easier to get to. The stadium also features a lot of parking, something that the A's stadium won't have any of. According to the A's, the Aviators would remain in Las Vegas and remain the A's AAA team. That doesn't make a lot of sense, as they'd constantly be competing against each other for attendance in the same small market. During the special session, the A's were grilled over their attendance projections, as well as over the supposed economic benefits of the stadium. Nearly every economist on earth will tell you that publicly funded stadiums are a scam and they do more harm than good economically to the community. Despite this, Jeremy, for the record, Aguero, who is not an economist and is just a lawyer with a bachelor's degree in hotel management, assured everyone that it would be great for the community due to it being a great investment opportunity and it would lead to the creation of thousands of jobs. He of course left out that those jobs would be temporary. Steve Hill, LVCVA CEO, also lobbied hard for the A's during the special session. However, Hill, like Aguero, was not even registered as a lobbyist. Something we heard a lot during the special session is that it would be great for locals, and tickets would be very affordable. Tickets supposedly would start at just $12. I'm not sure how anyone bought that, considering Fisher's history of raising ticket prices and the fact that the Raiders have the most expensive ticket prices in the league. Another thing we heard from proponents of the bill was that no new taxes would be introduced by the bill. However, that money doesn't just come from nowhere. The use of tax credits and tax increment funding would simply take money from other sources that require it. So unless they plan to stop fixing roads, funding hospitals, or paying teachers, new taxes would have to be created to collect the funds to pay for those things. As many in Nevada know, the state is already not doing a good job with some of those things, such as paying teachers, and Nevada also ranks in the bottom half of the U.S. in healthcare. Critics of the bill pointed out that loopholes exist that could lead to John Fisher receiving well over the $380 million agreed upon as well. Considering Fisher is having a hard time financing this project, it is very well within the realm of possibility. One of the highlights of the special session came, though, when Cavill was grilled by Nevada State Senator Fabian Doñate over the live entertainment tax, as Cavill refused to answer a yes or no question if the A's would commit to paying the tax. Here's what took place.
Thank you so much for that, but that didn't answer my question. So again, it's a yes or no. Will you willingly commit to pay the live entertainment tax in the near future to fix the equity issue that exists?
Like I said, we are committed to being a great community partner in Southern Nevada. And investing, you know, over $1 billion to ensure
that still does not answer the question, sir. I'm asking you directly, yes or no. Will you commit to paying the equity issue that we see existence for the live entertainment tax?
The legislation as it's currently envisioned, you know, does not contemplate that. The project is based on, you know, what is currently proposed. And so we've been focusing on that as really the path forward for the team and for the community.
Thank you. I mean, I find that disingenuous. I asked you directly, you're going to be capturing this as part of your legislation, yet you can't even commit to doing it yourself. And so I think that's something that the taxpayers must know of this state, but I divert my questions for the next round. Thank you.
Cavill's refusal to answer no is not only a terrible look for him and the A's, but it must have embarrassed him a lot because he was not present later in the evening when the Nevada legislature had more questions for him. Another highlight was during the public comment section when former A's senior executive Steve Pastorino tore into the A's plan and directly called out Dave Cavill. Here's what he had to say.
Pastorino, P-A-S-T-O-R-I-N-O, and I live in Senator Dondero Loop's district. But from 2014 to 2018, I was a senior executive for the Oakland Athletics, living in Oakland, California. I worked for Dave Cavill and two desks over from Catherine Aker. There are so many holes in what the A's are trying to sell us that I can't cover it in 2 minutes, but just a few. First of all, the walking, talking bobblehead known as Dave Cavill can't even answer Senator Donate's questions today about whether the A's will participate in the live entertainment tax. You cannot trust Dave Cavill. My former colleague, Catherine Aker, sent here to do John Fisher's bidding, meekly offering $1 million in community support. How many fields does $1 million build? Those of us who are in Clark County who have seen our high schools redo all their football fields in recent years, $1 million is a drop in the bucket. The A's community programs are a joke in Oakland, and they're going to be no better here in Las Vegas. When asked by Senator Flores how much time, money, and effort the A's put into developing or drafting one player, no one could answer because the A's representatives aren't here talking to you. Well, the answer is years and years and millions of dollars, and yet they're going to try and cram a $380 million stadium scam in 10 days before us. Please, I urge you to give this more proper consideration.
This is one of the many public comments that was made against the stadium. Of course, they didn't allow for all the opposing comments to be heard, as they didn't want to showcase how against the bill the public really was. After public comment in both the Nevada Senate and Nevada Assembly asked their questions, they convened, and several days of inactivity followed as the Nevada legislature members went home for the weekend. It was clear at that point that the A's didn't possess enough votes for the bill to pass yet. Governor Lombardo, however, was holding off on signing several bills into law, using this as leverage. Lombardo was going to stop at nothing until the bill passed. When the Nevada legislature returned, there were more meetings with the A's executives behind the scenes. It soon became clear that things were moving closer to a vote, and both the Senate and Assembly were able to speak once again and air their concerns. There were definitely quite a few members from each house that seemed to be very against the bill. A's fans were hopeful for a no vote, but signs were pointing that the bill would at least pass the Senate. On June 13th, the bill would pass the Senate by a 13-8 vote. Some of the senators who had grilled the A's and expressed extreme concern ended up voting yes, like Senator Doñate. One has to wonder what made them change their minds. Some sort of backroom dealing isn't outside the realm of possibility, as it happens so often in politics. A's fans retained some hope, as there were rumors that it would face more opposition in the Assembly, but the next day on June 14th, it passed the Assembly by a 25-15 vote. Once again, many who were originally opposed to the bill ended up voting yes. On June 16th, Governor Lombardo signed the bill into law. It was announced on that date as well that a formal signing ceremony would take place in the coming weeks, but as of September 2023, no signing ceremony has taken place yet or has even been scheduled. We can still pretend there was one though, right? As you'd imagine, A's fans were crushed over the news that the bill passed, and many Nevada residents were not thrilled either, with some vowing to fight the stadium scam in any way they possibly could, but we'll focus more on that later. Due to the special session drawing out, MLB owners were not able to vote on the A's relocation during their meetings from June 13th to June 15th. John Fisher was asked for comment by a reporter, but declined to do so, as he always has. Up to that point, in 18 years as an owner, Fisher had never spoken to the press and had never ever been interviewed, so this came as no surprise. Rob Manfred also made comments in regards to the A's situation during these meetings, but that will be covered in Part 6 when the reverse boycott is discussed. Additionally, it came out on the last day of the owners' meetings that Milwaukee Brewers owner Mark Attanasio would head the A's relocation committee responsible for relocating the A's from Oakland to Las Vegas. One big responsibility for the relocation committee is to define the new operating territory and television territory, a relocation application that explains why Vegas is a better market and the efforts Oakland has made must also be submitted. Later on, Philadelphia Phillies owner John Middleton and Kansas City Royals owner John Sherman were added to the committee in July. It was a blatant conflict of interest to include Attanasio and Sherman, as Attanasio was in the middle of trying to extort over $500 million from Wisconsin taxpayers for upgrades for a ballpark that was barely 20 years old and even threatening relocation while doing so. And Sherman was, and still is, seeking $1 billion in public funding for a new stadium for the Royals. It obviously would serve their best interest to recommend relocation, as it shows that the threat of relocation is real if these billionaires aren't given everything they want. It was reported later on from multiple sources from within MLB that it was not an accident that MLB asked Attanasio to be a part of the committee. In August, the A's announced they had selected a Mortensen-McCarthy joint venture as the construction manager for the team's ballpark. They were also responsible for building Allegiant Stadium, which is generally viewed as an above-average stadium, but it certainly isn't without its issues, as the roof has already had leaks despite being less than 5 years old. On August 23rd, the A's officially submitted their relocation application. The biggest news of August 23rd, though, was John Fisher finally giving an interview, something he had never done before as A's owner. In fact, he'd given two interviews, one the day prior and one that day, and the transcripts of both were released on the 23rd. However, there was no video or audio of these interviews, and to say he was tossed softballs would be vastly understating it. The first interview came out with the Las Vegas Review-Journal, which is one of the more biased news sites out there, not just in terms of media bias, but they've also been incredibly biased towards supporting the A's and their Vegas ballpark plan. Their lackey is Mick Akers, who at times seems more like he is just Dave Cavill and John Fisher in a trench coat. He has zero integrity as a journalist. In fact, calling him a journalist is an insult to journalists everywhere. He's been nothing but a giant mouthpiece for the A's, as it's been purely all propaganda and PR. With this so-called interview, it is rather apparent Fisher was sent these questions in advance and likely had someone type up their responses for him. Now we'll look into some of his responses. Early on in the interview, he stated that he has not considered selling the team. He stated that his goal since he bought the team in 2005 was to find a new home and build a new home for the team. He added that he thinks the ballpark on the strip would be iconic and added, "It's going to be great for the community, and which we think is going to be great for not only the A's and our fans, but all of the baseball and really all of sports. I'm not sure how exactly this would be great for A's fans, but he said it, not me. The A's will be lucky to retain 2% of their fan base after this move." When asked if the A's would field a competitive team in Vegas, Fisher said that the new stadium will allow them to spend more due to increased revenue. This is something that Fisher absolutely cannot be trusted with, as Fisher's earthquake still remained as frugal as ever, despite having a new stadium and promises the team would spend more. When asked more specifically about what kind of payroll the A's would have, Fisher stated that the payroll would be funded by the team revenue and that he expects revenue to be higher, which would lead to a higher payroll. He would not straight up commit to a higher payroll. When talking about revenue, he mentioned MLB's central funding playing a role in their revenue. Central funding, of course, includes both MLB central fund and revenue sharing, with revenue sharing being the main thing he's referring to here. Considering Vegas is a much smaller market than the Bay Area, being in Vegas will ensure that Fisher will forever remain on billionaire welfare and leech off the other owners. That is his goal above all else. In fact, due to the smaller market, his revenue sharing checks will actually be even bigger, which is probably the main reason he's fallen in love with the idea of moving to Vegas. As we know, this revenue sharing has always gone directly into his pocket, never to be seen again. Does anyone really think the guy who had to be publicly shamed into paying his employees during a pandemic is ever going to open his wallet? When asked about financing, he mentioned his family was going to contribute a large amount and said that they'd been working with Goldman Sachs. It is apparent that he had not yet been able to secure and finalize the funding for the $1 billion needed, and many remain skeptical that he will be able to fund the project. He was also asked about the A's profit. Fisher claimed the A's had lost $40 million in 2023 and $175 million in the last few years. It goes without saying, this isn't even remotely close to true. Let's take a moment and look into it. Gate revenue for the A's was $30 million in 2022, and with attendance higher in 2023 compared to 2022, along with higher ticket prices, the A's will make over $30 million in gate revenue in 2023. Additionally, there is the local TV deal, which is over $67 million, along with national TV deals as well as streaming deals, and all teams get a share of the latter two, which totals to almost $62 million. These three things right here add up to almost $130 million for the A's. Throw in revenue sharing, which the A's will get at least $27 million of in 2023, and add that up with the TV and streaming deal total along with the gate revenue, and that is nearly $190 million. When you factor in merchandise, parking, concessions, local and national sponsorship revenue, gaming partnerships, etc., this number is probably much higher. Of course, they have expenses, like their league worst payroll of just $50 million, their $1.25 million lease payment, Vegas lobbyists, etc., but that $40 million loss is probably more like a $40 million profit. I'll include a link to the Forbes article that goes into detail on the subject in the description, as it's definitely worth the read. Earlier this year, Forbes had reported the A's made $29 million in profit in 2022. It is beyond clear that Fisher's claim of all those losses is a lie, but let's just pretend for a moment that it wasn't. Let's say he actually did lose that much money. Why would you be admitting that? You'd basically be telling everyone you don't know how to run one of the most profitable businesses in the country. Why would the owner support someone that is so bad with their money? Why is losing this much money something to brag about? Also, it's kind of important to invest in your product, and you shouldn't be intentionally sabotaging it. If you treat your consumers like dirt and never invest a dime into anything related to your product, it's not hard to see why your product sucks and you aren't attracting many consumers. The bottom line is, Fisher is lying about his losses to try and justify his extremely unpopular attempted relocation of the A's. Plain and simple. Back to the interview now, Fisher was asked about fans and critics accusing him of deliberately tanking the team. In response to this, Fisher brought up the $40 million lost lie again and said, "We have done everything we can to try and build ourselves back up and become a highly competitive team again." I don't even need to get into that lie, as all available evidence contradicts this statement. When asked about the A's historically bad season, Fisher started with his answer with, "We won last night," and mentioned the A's had lost a lot of close games, demonstrating he either has not been paying attention to how truly awful the A's have been this year, or that he doesn't understand baseball all that well. He was also asked about Mayor Tao's remark about the land agreement announcement being done in bad faith. He mentioned that the A's had spent 6 years working with Oakland on Howard Terminal, that Oakland did not have the money and did not raise the money to cover the off-site infrastructure, the stadium might not be ready until 2031 or beyond, and that a deal was needed by January 2024, or the team would lose revenue sharing, which Fisher said would have a devastating impact on the team. He finished off the question by saying they wouldn't have met the date in Oakland, and that they did not have a deal there. These statements all warrant discussion. To start, it is a straight-up lie to say the A's spent 6 years on Howard Terminal. For starters, the plan was announced in November 2018, which was less than 4.5 years from the A's April announcement. Additionally, not only was there a pandemic during those 4.5 years, but the A's spent two of those years focusing on Vegas with parallel paths. Another thing to add is that the A's were the ones that kept asking for extensions, not Oakland. It was the A's who were moving slowly. An anonymous Bay Area developer, whom the A's approached to invest in Howard Terminal years ago, had even said the A's timelines, as well as costs and exit projections, were unrealistic, and he had also noted that Cavill's inexperience in mixed-use developments was very clear. As for the comment about Oakland not being able to meet the A's asks financially, that was also a lie and a classic case of Fisher moving the goalposts, but we'll get into the actual numbers later. The 2031 comment was a lie, as the A's would have had shovels on the ground in Oakland before Vegas had Fisher seen the Howard Terminal plan through. For one, the process was much farther along in Oakland. Second, is that Bally's said in May they did not plan to demolish the Tropicana Hotel for another 18 to 24 months, so construction in Vegas could start as late as summer 2025. It's funny, Cavill had said that 2027 would be far too late for the ballpark to open in Oakland, yet they are fine with a 2028 opening date in Las Vegas, although 2029 appears much more likely. Additionally, if the A's had asked simply for just a ballpark with no ancillary development or parking on just 9 acres of leased land instead of 55 acres they'd own, the shovels would have been in the ground years ago. As for the revenue sharing comment, Fisher is literally admitting that it is all about the revenue sharing for him. He just doesn't want to lose that billionaire welfare that will help him fatten his wallet. It's why they rushed into this half-baked Vegas plan at the last second. Fisher was going to do anything to keep that revenue sharing. A deal could have absolutely been made in Oakland well before January 2024, as progress was being made at the summit, but the A's backed out when the deal was close. Let's not forget, January 2024 was only an issue because the A's, not Oakland, missed a deadline in September 2023. Later on in the interview, Fisher said, "I got into the sport because I want to win," which couldn't be anything farther from the truth. When asked about his background in baseball, Fisher said he had become a fan from attending Giants games with his grandparents, but admitted that he liked the cotton candy and Red Vines licorice more than the games. Those are just some of the highlights of the interview, but I'll link the full interview in the description. It was apparent that the interview was an attempt to humanize John Fisher, as he even mentioned his sons during the interview. It has never once been mentioned before anywhere that Fisher even has children. In fact, it even says in online bios that he has none. He does have 4 children, though, and bringing them up seemed like an attempt to humanize himself. One has to wonder if Rob Manfred or Dave Cavill made Fisher do this so-called interview, as the fact that Fisher was making all these immensely unpopular decisions and not providing any answers or even allowing any questions to be asked angered everyone for so long. This was nothing but PR. As I mentioned, there was a second interview. This interview was conducted by NBC Bay Area's Raj Mathai. The interview took place at one of John Fisher's many homes, specifically in the guest house of his Atherton property. That was surely intentional, as it probably wouldn't have come off all that well for him to be interviewed inside of his mansion. A's fans had been hoping Mathai would ask Fisher some hard questions and grill him after his live-filled responses, but unfortunately, Mathai tossed more softballs. Again, neither of these interviews were taped and there is no audio. At the very least, this one had some pictures. In this shot, you can see Catherine Aker hiding in the background, possibly there to answer questions for Fisher. Also seen is a notepad with the names Mark Kotze, Tyler Soderstrom, and Zach Geloff written on it. It appears Fisher needed to be reminded of who managed the team he owns, as well as who the team's top up-and-coming players were. Early on in the interview, Fisher was asked why he was relocating the team. He once again reiterated it was because he wants to win. Meanwhile, A's fans are still searching the ends of the earth to find evidence that he actually wants to win. When asked about why he hasn't considered selling the team, he mentioned he got into the game to win and that he put everything he had in the last 6 years trying to get the Howard Terminal ballpark built, and that the A's spent over $100 million trying to get it done. Once again, he says he wants to win, which he doesn't. He lies about the 6 years spent on Howard Terminal, and the $100 million spent is a complete and utter lie. The A's have never elaborated on where that number came from, and the City of Oakland has said that they have only billed the A's for $8 million in city staff and consultant time, including outside legal counsel. There could be other costs, but in no world did the A's pay anything even remotely close to this amount. Mathai also asked Fisher if the sell shirts and the sell the team chants were hurtful, and Fisher said that it was hurtful to him. This is something everyone is having a hard time believing, as people like him care about one thing and one thing only, and that's money. He's made it pretty clear that he doesn't care about his image as long as he's making money. If he was actually hurt, though, you know what would make those chants stop? Selling the team. When asked what his message to A's fans was, Fisher said he did an awful lot of great things for the team and said he did an awful lot to be a good steward to the franchise for the fans. He also said that moving to Las Vegas gives the team the best chance for success. I'm pretty sure every A's fan on the planet would take offense to those first two statements, and as we discussed earlier, there's no reason to believe the A's will be more successful in Vegas than in a new ballpark in Oakland. Fisher was also asked about being close to a deal in Oakland, and Fisher denied this, saying, Oakland hadn't met their commitments and hadn't raised the money needed. He also brought up revenue sharing again, saying they were almost out of time to reach a binding agreement. He once again lied, as Oakland had met commitment for the A's original demand, and he also reinforced that Santa revenue sharing was his main goal. He later said he felt pressure from the collective bargaining agreement, but he feels like Vegas is the right path forward for the team and its fans, and for the ability to build a winning team. However, I'd argue the number of A's fans who believe this is the right path forward for the team and its fans is probably less than 10. Fisher was also asked if the A's would spend money on big-name free agents in Vegas, something that he claimed he would do if the A's got a new ballpark. He completely dodged the question, though, and said the A's would be able to keep their best players. The fact that he can't commit to signing big-name free agents should be a major red flag for the very few people in Vegas who actually want the A's. It's also doubtful Fisher will just magically open his wallet, and I wouldn't even expect the A's to retain their best players either. When asked if he went to games a lot, Fisher admitted he hadn't gone to any games this year, but claimed he had gone to a lot of games in the past. I'm sure many would like to dispute this claim, as he is rarely ever seen at the Coliseum. Once again, these were just the highlights of the interview, and a link to the full transcript can be found in the description. Many believe that Fisher had prior knowledge of the questions, just as he did with the Las Vegas Review-Journal interview, but Raj Mathai denied sharing his questions with him beforehand, saying that only NBC Bay Area personnel would have had access to them, which makes me question who on NBC Bay Area's staff leaked Fisher the questions in advance. The interview with Mathai was incredibly disappointing, considering that Mathai didn't ask any tough questions and failed to point out the lies in Fisher's responses. The interview was clearly on Fisher's terms, and NBC Bay Area was chosen to conduct the interview due to agreeing to those terms. In fact, some of Fisher's answers were even edited after the fact. It was all just another PR attempt to show Fisher in a positive light and to try and humanize him. Understandably, Mathai and NBC Bay Area received a lot of heat for some of the soft questions, so they attempted to fix things a bit by interviewing Mayor Tao to get her side of the story about a week later. She started out by saying, every 2 weeks the A's have a new narrative out on how it was Oakland's fault and not theirs, and she hit the nail right on the head with this one. The A's acting this way dates back to the early days of the Howard Terminal negotiations. Mayor Tao also said that Oakland went beyond what the A's had asked of, not just for the ballpark, but also the surrounding development. She added that she can't help but feel like this was the A's scheme all along, to say that it was the city's fault and then they had no choice but to relocate to a new city. She also said that Oakland had met the A's original ask for funding, and that the new gap in funding could easily be bridged. She also said the A's had been moving the goalposts, and it was often unclear what the A's real request even was. The mayor is 100% right, as Oakland had met the A's original ask. The A's originally had asked for $360 million for off-site infrastructure. Oakland met what was asked for this. It was then reported the A's were seeking over $400 million, and Oakland met this, raising $475 million. Then, the A's raised the price twice more, saying they needed $568 million, and then again to $576 million. Despite Oakland being only at $475 million, two grants were soon due to pay out, which would put Oakland at $540 million raised. That's only a $36 million gap. More recent reports have even indicated the gap is actually as small as $25 million. A gap of $25 to $36 million is nothing and could have easily been bridged. Additionally, although this has been seldom reported, Oakland proposed a limited obligation bond of $150 million. The limited obligation bond would be backed by the revenues created by the waterfront ballpark district itself and would not put the city's general fund at risk. So, with that being said, with the limited obligation bond, there is no gap. Also to note, the amount raised, excluding the limited obligation bond, is still $160 million more than Vegas was giving the A's. It is clear by the ever-changing number that the A's moved the goalposts every time the city of Oakland met what the A's asked, and if Oakland had met the $576 million mark, it is likely the A's would have changed that number again. On the flip side, Fisher asked for $500 million in Nevada, but was fine with $380 instead. It seems like the A's were fine with moving the goalposts the opposite way for Vegas. When the mayor was asked about Fisher's comments about nothing with Howard Terminal being approved, Mayor Tao said they were very close to that point and it only hadn't reached that point yet due to the A's not making an effort to get it to that point. She added multiple times throughout the bargaining session, dating back to Libby Schaaf's term as mayor, the A's had requested multiple times for a longer timeline and multiple delays. Another thing that I would like to discuss in regards to the Howard Terminal project is the affordable housing component to the deal, which is often misrepresented in discussion. It has been reported by some that Oakland was asking for 35% of the new housing units built on Howard Terminal to be affordable housing. This simply was not the case, but this misinformation led to many to believe that this is what Oakland wanted and asked for. In reality, Oakland asked for 15% affordable housing. The A's, meanwhile, only wanted to commit 5%. The legal amount required is 7-12%, as it can vary depending on project details. So in reality, the disagreement was over at most 8%, as it would have had to be no lower than 7%. Yet there are people out there who want everyone to believe there was a 30% difference. Cavill himself went on record in August 2022 saying that the affordable housing issues were mostly solved. Maritau had also stated the same as well. In comparison, the San Francisco Giants Mission Rock development, which is south of Oracle Park, has 40% affordable housing, so the 15% Oakland was asking for is nothing. Moving on now. An article by Maury Brown of Forbes was released on September 11, 2023 that detailed the financials between the A's alleged $40 million loss. According to Brown, the A's financial details were provided by a high-placed baseball industry insider with intimate knowledge of the finances provided the details on a condition of anonymity. So in other words, Dave Cavill. It is very clear this information was leaked intentionally to try and show the A's really did lose $40 million in 2023, although as we all know, they really didn't. The data presented appeared to show a near $40 million loss for the A's, but the data did not provide a full breakdown or exact specifics. One must question the accuracy of the data presented, as it could be polished in such a way that makes it look like Fisher's claims are true. Any accountant can make a profit appear as a loss if the books are done in such a way. Brown also admitted he was unable to verify all the data. The data also showed the A's operating expenses jumped by $35 million from 2022 to 2023. An industry insider said this was likely due to filling front office holes, but in reality, that $35 million, if that number is even real, likely went to lobbyists in Nevada. As Field of Schemes writer Neil DeMaus said, it's certainly possible the A's can show a $39 million loss under generally accepted accounting principles, but that doesn't mean that it's necessarily a loss. With all this being said, take the financial leak with a grain of salt. On September 14th, it was reported that the MLB owners' vote on the A's relocation is expected to take place during the owners' meetings in mid-November. 75% of team owners need to vote in favor of the move for the relocation to be approved. Other than the A's gifting Miguel Cabrera, one of the greatest hitters of the generation, who also happens to be a recovering alcoholic who has sworn off alcohol, with a $75 bottle of wine, the last and most recent bit of news that came out was an ESPN article by Tim Kuhn that included some excerpts from ESPN's interview with John Fisher from August. One thing Fisher said during the interview was that he couldn't understand how the city of Oakland could say they felt blindsided by the Vegas announcement, as he said things were nowhere after 4 years of negotiations. We know that is simply untrue. Mayor Tao responded to this by saying, "To say we were nowhere is BS. To say there was no proposal is total BS. Let's be clear, we did have a proposal, but maybe it wasn't a proposal that John Fisher could afford." As for Cavill's claims about someone leaking to the press about the A's binding agreement in Vegas, Mayor Tao's chief of staff Lee Hansen had this to say. "Not sure it's a leak when you're quoted in the story, pretty sure that's not how a leak works. If you're going to be strategic, try not to be sloppy." I guess Cavill assumed that nobody in the mayor's office knew how to read. Also in the interview, Fisher was asked if he specifically had asked Rob Manfred to waive the relocation fee, and he could not give a yes or no answer to the question, leading many to believe he did indeed ask Manfred for it to be waived. According to an industry source with knowledge of the situation, the relocation fee was waived because the stadium project in Vegas would not be economically feasible for Fisher. This should raise a big red flag, as it shows that Howard Terminal was never really an option because Fisher couldn't afford it. In response to accusations Fisher was lying about how much money the team lost, all he could say was, "I should know, I write the checks." Fisher then brought up how much he had to pay to the A's draft picks in July, which is something that is directly attributable to slashing payroll and talent after the 2021 season. Fisher said, "We ended up with a much higher pick, and you know, it's an opportunity, but it's an expensive opportunity to sign high draft picks." The A's top pick in the 2023 draft was shortstop Jacob Wilson, whom the A's signed for $1 million below slot value for the 6th overall pick. It's absolutely unreal to hear an owner complain about having to pay a draft pick. Maybe if he didn't want to have to pay his draft picks as much, he could have actually tried to field a competitive team and the draft picks wouldn't have been as high. Fisher and Cavill were asked about the Earthquakes, Fisher's soccer team, a team Cavill had been president of, who had promised to bolster their roster and compete for championships after building a new stadium, and as we know, that promise was not kept. In 2020, Fisher sold a few properties adjacent to PayPal Park and made $275 million from doing so. He has plenty of money to invest in the team if he wants to. In a league where 18 of 29 teams make the playoffs, the Earthquakes have not won a single playoff game since 2012 and have only qualified for the playoffs twice in the 8 years since the stadium opened. The Earthquakes have also consistently remained in the bottom of MLS and payroll. Fisher said comparing the A's and Earthquakes is apples to oranges, and Cavill completely dodged the question, saying, "I'm a big believer in the revenue opportunity in Las Vegas." Fisher then added that PayPal Park in San Jose is already outdated. Yes, he is placing the blame on a stadium, one he had built with designs he approved, for the Earthquakes' frugal spending, a stadium that is only 8 years old. This outraged Earthquake fans enough that Fisher released a statement recently that completely contradicted everything he just mentioned here. If the A's meet their target date for a 2028 opening day in Las Vegas, does that mean that in 2036 Fisher's excuse for a bad team and low payroll will be an outdated stadium? Will he threaten relocation if Clark County doesn't give him hundreds of millions for upgrades like so many other owners have done? Given Fisher's history, it almost seems like a certainty. Fisher was asked about if any local ownership groups had approached him and offered to buy the team from him so they could remain in Oakland, similar to in 1992, when he begged his father for his family to join a Giants ownership group so that they could help prevent the Giants' relocation. Fisher shook his head and pretty much dismissed the question, saying he wasn't going to comment on inquiries, and also said, "Like I said, I'm a local guy, right? Bay Area native, and so I think if there was anyone who was going to give it their all to try and make it work, it was going to be me." No one believes this statement. Meanwhile, Mayor Tao said she has heard from multiple buyers who are very viable, who are willing to buy the team and do anything to make it work for them to stay in Oakland. She added, though, "The problem, of course, is you can't buy something that isn't for sale." There is widespread belief around baseball that Fisher will sell the team once he gets a new stadium built in Vegas, as the team's valuation would skyrocket, a pump-and-dump type deal. As it stands right now, Fisher purchased the team for $180 million, and the A's are now worth $1.2 billion. But apparently selling now wouldn't be enough of a profit for the man worth $2.5 billion. Fisher denies the rumors that he would sell the team after the Vegas move, saying, "I got into baseball because I was a fan and I loved the game, and I always thought the A's had this incredible history to them. As I told somebody the other day, I don't really feel like I'm an owner because I think with baseball teams and other sport teams, you're really a kind of caretaker for creating a legacy of additional history for your club. And that's what I hope to create for us in Vegas." If that's truly what Fisher believes, he has 100% failed his job as caretaker. I think the word Fisher is looking for is undertaker, not caretaker. He single-handedly turned one of baseball's most historic teams into a laughingstock and is responsible for ripping said team away from its home of 55 years, costing hundreds of people their jobs and destroying hundreds of thousands of fans' love for baseball, some legacy to leave behind. Part 6, The Fight Back. Despite being subjected to decades of terrible ownership and cruel treatment, saying A's fans have been resilient would be an understatement. A's fans have a lot of fight in them, and they're not a fan base you want to mess with. Since the early days of Fisher, and even before his ownership, A's fans have been extremely vocal in voicing their support for the team to commit to Oakland and have never been hesitant to call out ownership's lies. Whether it is with a creative sign at the game, creating t-shirts with popular slogans, networking on social media to create a protest or event, or simply by replying to posts on social media attempting to try and correct the narrative, A's fans have always made sure their voices were heard and they've always rallied together, even if everything has always been stacked against them. A long-used narrative by fans of other teams and many in the media is that A's fans don't show up to support the team. As this video has already established, A's fans are absolutely not at fault for this. A's fans have been driven away systematically for years by ownership. In April of this year, A's fan Stu Clary suggested the idea of a reverse boycott. The idea of the reverse boycott was to show everyone that it's not the fault of A's fans that they don't pack the park, it's the fault of ownership. The date June 13th was chosen for the reverse boycott, which was a Tuesday night game versus the Tampa Bay Rays. Tuesday nights were often some of the more sparsely populated A's games, and the Rays weren't exactly a team that a lot of people came to see, which is why the game was specifically chosen. A's fans wanted to show that they could pack any game if they wanted to. This was announced shortly before the A's Vegas announcement, and although the announcement temporarily took some life out of some fans, plans still continued as momentum gradually began to grow for the game. The Oakland 68s, an independent supporters group for the Oakland A's, Oakland Roots, and Oakland Soul, and the City of Oakland overall, were some of the leaders behind the event, as well as those from Last Dive Bar, who are a group of A's fans that sell unique fan-inspired A's clothing and gear. Besides many posts to social media about the event, articles began to appear about the upcoming reverse boycott as well. Meanwhile, A's fans were staying busy at the Coliseum, chanting "Sell the team," "Fisher sucks," and other chants directed at John Fisher. They were also holding up and hanging up all sorts of signs directed at Fisher, Cavill, and Manfred. These all became mainstays at every A's home game. The A's broadcast tried to avoid showing these signs at all costs, but at times, they were forced to show them, like when a player would hit a home run into right field, where the diehard fans often had dozens of signs directed at Fisher and Cavill. In the past, security often confiscated such signs. They'd been instructed to do so by A's higher-ups, but now it was different. A's employees are not only tired of being treated poorly, but their jobs are now being threatened with the A's relocation, and all the signs began to stay up, as they also knew that A's fans were fighting for their jobs as well. The A's broadcast not only avoided showing these signs, but they never even addressed them or the chants, and crowd noise was often suppressed at times as well. MLB also tried their hand at censorship, as in late April they were caught using a significantly cropped video of a home run that was hit by A's first baseman Ryan Noda. Here is the original video of the home run, followed by the clip that MLB had on their website.
Ruiz is now 11 for 11 in stolen bases this year. That one's hit high and deep to right field. Fraley turns around, and that baby's gone.
As you can imagine, there was an enormous uproar over this, and it led to the Streisand effect, as their attempt to censor these signs led to significantly more attention to them. MLB released a statement saying they were unaware that there was any edit and soon corrected it, but no one really bought that because they absolutely knew what they were doing. Something that was also nice to see was all the journalists who began covering the A's situation. Many were shining light on John Fisher's terrible ownership and were defending A's fans. It was refreshing to see people siding with A's fans for once. A's fans were also busy, finding and sharing to social media any and all evidence that demonstrated what was happening was all Fisher's fault, as well as demonstrating what a terrible owner and person he was. This was definitely having some sort of an effect, as John Fisher and the phrase "sell the team" were constantly trending on Twitter. We were also beginning to see more fans throughout baseball siding with A's fans and pointing the finger at Fisher. Public opinion was slowly turning, and this led to an increase in articles written about Fisher, the A's, and the whole situation. As June rolled around, I personally began keeping track of the tickets sold for the June 13th reverse boycott. I used the team website to manually count the number of tickets sold in each section. It was a long process, but I wanted to keep track of things to see if the A's used any trickery to sabotage attendance for the reverse boycott, as a low attendance for such an event would strengthen the narrative that fans are at fault. One thing that I noticed once June 13th rolled around, large blocks of seats that had previously been grayed out were now open. It's possible the A's did this to create empty sections that would be visible during the game. By my final count, the A's had sold nearly 27,100 tickets before I left to attend the game. There was a lot of buzz heading into this game, and tailgaters arrived hours before the stadium gates opened. News crews were on site interviewing A's fans. Also, over 7,000 sell shirts were distributed by the Oakland 68s in the parking lot. Over 5,000 had been raised to produce these shirts, leading to the first ever crowd-funded fan giveaway. Unfortunately, there was a concert next door which caused extremely long waiting lines to get into the parking lot, and eventually, the lot had filled up and cars began to get turned away. Once entering the Coliseum, you could feel the electricity that was in the air and you could tell it was going to be an unforgettable night. Fans were everywhere and hundreds of signs could be seen throughout the entire stadium. Some signs were straight and to the point, some were more on the humorous side, and some were on the explicit side. Everyone there had something to say and a message to send. I made and brought my own sign with a friend, and we popped up in different areas of the third deck and had some help from fans holding it up. Due to the nature of the sign, I had to blur out some of it so this video wouldn't get age-restricted. It was straight to the point, though, and received rather well by A's fans. The best part of the game, though, was the energy from the crowd. There were chants going all game, and fans were going nuts after every A's hit or strikeout by an A's pitcher, even though the A's were at last place in the standings, but the best moment by far was in the top of the fifth inning. Thanks to some coordination beforehand, the entire crowd went silent for the first batter at the top of the fifth. This at-bat would result in a double down the line by Jose Siri of the Rays, and as soon as the ball was thrown back into the infield, a chant louder than anything I'd ever heard boomed throughout the Coliseum. The noise and energy resembled that of a playoff game. Let's listen.
Allergic to it. And she believed it all the way until she was like 18 years old. Swinging a fair ball inside the third baseline, and Siri's going to turn and make his way to second, and he has notions about third. He'll put the brakes on as Seth gets it back in. We heard the crowd go silent and now getting very loud at the Coliseum. Thank you. Wells will now stand in for Tampa Bay. Rays trying to open the scoring, and Hogan can't hear with the pitch calm because of the crowd. And now time is called. Things have gotten loud here, and this is certainly a new experience in 2023 at the Coliseum. Technology, you got to make sure it works, right? I mean, pretty significant time. May have caught Hogan by surprise.
As you saw there, the noise was so loud that A's pitcher Hogan Harris thought his pitch comm was broken and had to call time. It was truly an incredible moment, one that anyone who was in attendance will never forget. Unfortunately, as I had mentioned earlier, the long lines to get in and the closed lot led to many fans not even being able to get into the game at all. The A's were also severely understaffed, which only worsened parking issues. There were a fair amount of people who had said they were going to buy tickets at the gate, so a lot of people weren't able to make it in at any point or even buy tickets, and some fans who did make it did not arrive until as late as the 8th or 9th inning. The total attendance ended up being 27,759, which was the A's biggest crowd of the season at that point and was over three times larger than the A's average attendance. There are a few important things to note though. First off, I was certain there were at least 30,000 people there. I've been to tons of A's games, and that 27,000 number seemed a bit low. They also announced the attendance numbers rather early in the game, in the fourth inning, while hundreds of fans were still online trying to get in. I've heard from a source in the A's ticketing offices that attendance was indeed over 30,000 and that 32,604 tickets were sold by the end of the game. Interestingly, MLB always counts attendance by number of tickets sold, but they did not do so for June 13th. There were a lot of critics mentioning that most of the third deck was empty. While technically true, most people didn't realize that most third deck sections were completely grayed out and have been all season. In fact, for most games this year, all but 9 of the 35 sections in the third deck had been grayed out, including for June 13th, so it wasn't even possible to buy tickets for those sections. Of course, Mount Davis is always closed as well. So while the stadium can technically hold up to 56,000 fans, with Mount Davis closed, that number drops below 47,000. With 26 out of 35 third deck sections closed, that number dropped significantly lower. There were also several sections in the second deck in which it was not possible to purchase a ticket for. By my accounts, the most tickets the A's could have actually sold for the game was 32,639, so the A's were actually extremely close to selling out, as they were just 35 tickets sold away from reaching that number. If anyone had been able to get into the parking lot and get tickets, it's possible people might have gotten turned away or the A's would have been forced to open up more sections. What A's fans were able to do that night was extremely impressive, and it was something to be very proud of. The A's ended up winning the game 2-1 as well, sending everyone home incredibly happy. A's fans more than sent their message and had the most fun they'd had at a game in years. Their energy was off the charts, and it was truly a night I and tens of thousands of A's fans will never forget. The A's made a PR move that day by donating all the proceeds from tickets sold that game to local charities. It was rather shameful that they used the efforts of the fans to make themselves try and look good. Trust me, the man worth $2.5 billion that only donated $25,000 to the A's Community Fund over a four-year period doesn't actually care about local charities. It was all just a show for the Nevada legislature, to show that they were capable of pretending to care about a community. It was a futile attempt to try and deflect some of the heat as well. Since this took place during the owners' meetings, Rob Manfred was asked about the reverse boycott and A's relocation efforts. He took the opportunity to take a dig at A's fans by saying this snarky comment, "I mean, it was great. It is great to see what is this year is almost an average Major League Baseball crowd in the facility for one night. That's a great thing." Which was an incredibly insulting comment towards A's fans, who, as we've already established, do not attend a lot of games due to Fisher's sabotage of the franchise, poor treatment of fans, and relocation efforts. Something that Manfred and MLB owners are apparently more than happy to allow. Manfred's comments enraged A's fans, and he wasn't even done yet. He then made a comment directed towards the city of Oakland in which everything he said was completely false. He said, "I think the real question is what it is that Oakland is prepared to do. There is no Oakland offer. I mean, they never got to the point where they had a plan to build a stadium at any site, and it's not just John Fisher. You don't build a stadium based on club activity alone. The community has to provide support. And you know, at some point, you come to the realization it's just not going to happen." His statement was completely ridiculous. Oakland had met everything the A's had originally asked for and gave the A's all the delays and extensions they asked for. They worked tirelessly to try and make the Howard Terminal Ballpark and all its surrounding development a reality, only for the A's to walk away close to the finish line. In fact, the last five Oakland mayors have either advocated for Howard Terminal site or were actually working with the A's on making it a reality. How on earth can Manfred claim that there was not a plan to build a stadium at any site? The community provided the support and then some. Later on, Manfred tried to claim the comments were taken out of context, but said, "Unfortunately, one night doesn't change a decade of inaction." Whether this comment was directed at A's fans or Oakland isn't clear, but we do know that what he's saying simply isn't true in either case. He also added that he felt sorry for the fans and hated the idea of moving, but they did everything they possibly could to try and keep the club in Oakland. Literally everything Manfred said was a lie. The fight back was not just one involving A's fans, but Mayor Tao has also been interviewed several times to refute whatever the A's latest lie about the negotiations with the City of Oakland is. She's been incredibly transparent about the process, and the City of Oakland has released documentation detailing everything. If you have time, please check out the FAQ page on Howard Terminal on the City of Oakland's website. I'll put a link in the description. During All-Star Weekend in Seattle back in July, Mayor Tao went to Seattle along with a cart full of documents and met with Rob Manfred and Deputy Commissioner Dan Halem. Mayor Tao got Manfred up to speed on Oakland's side of things and where things really stood when the A's walked away from negotiations. The meeting reportedly went well as Mayor Tao was able to get Manfred up to speed, and she also brought copies of the documentation for all of MLB's owners as well. Unfortunately, Manfred being Manfred continued to stick with the narrative that it was all Oakland's fault, since he blames the political process in Oakland for things not working out. It is also doubtful that he handed out the material to the other owners, and everything he was told probably went in one ear and out the other. One area that Oakland has some leverage in is that the A's lease expires after the 2024 season. The A's would obviously need a place to play in 2025, 2026, and 2027, and possibly even 2028 until the Vegas ballpark is ready, and it would definitely be the easiest for them to extend their lease at the Coliseum. The A's have floated sharing Oracle Park with the Giants, but it is not likely something the Giants would agree to, and they have yet to comment on the proposal. It has also been floated the A's could play in the Aviators ballpark or perhaps even in Reno, home of the AAA team, the Reno Aces, but those ballparks are not even close to being viable ballparks for a Major League team, even if just temporarily. There's also speculation that the MLB Players Association would contest players having to play in those conditions, especially if they had to play in a ballpark without a roof during Vegas's hot summers. With all this being said, Mayor Tao has some stipulations in mind if the A's want to extend their Coliseum lease beyond 2024. These demands could reportedly include the A's name staying in Oakland or even a guarantee that Oakland receives an expansion team. If the A's are going to leave, Oakland should definitely not make it easy on them or MLB. If they want to stay in the Coliseum for longer, Oakland deserves at least some sort of compensation other than the lease payment itself. If MLB and the A's are not willing to meet these asks, Oakland should show them the door as soon as possible. There is zero reason to help out the A's if they're leaving unless it will somehow benefit the City of Oakland down the road. Mayor Tao's Chief of Staff Lee Hansen said that Mayor Tao has already informed Manfred of these stipulations, and this took place during the Seattle meeting. During an interview with the San Francisco Chronicle, Manfred denied that such a conversation ever took place. Hansen said that the topic definitely came up and that she was in the room when it did. Manfred, who referred to Hansen as a hatchet person, denied the Coliseum lease, Oakland's expansion, or Oakland keeping the A's name were ever discussed. Manfred, who was reportedly very agitated at times during the interview, questioned Mayor Tao's conduct and suggested she should take the blame for losing the A's. Manfred said, "It looks like she's going to lose yet another franchise from the Bay Area. That's unfortunate, that's a tough spot to be in, but I think we've gotten to the point where she's not telling people the truth." Now, before we go any further, I just want to point out that Manfred said that it looks like Oakland was going to be losing another team. The fact that he is so sure about this just drives home the fact that the whole relocation committee process is a sham. He already knows what the recommendation of the committee will be, and he knows how the owners will vote. In this rigged game, Oakland doesn't stand a chance. The Chronicle informed the mayor's office of Manfred's recent claims, and Hansen reiterated that the lease was brought up by Mayor Tao. Manfred also tried to criticize the mayor, saying that it was not productive when she said she was ending negotiations with the A's, but said that she would still pick up the phone when they called. What he failed to mention is the reason why Mayor Tao cut off on the negotiations was because John Fisher literally told her that they were going to focus all their attention on Vegas. Why on earth would someone continue negotiations with someone who said they were going to focus all their efforts on leaving? And most importantly, let's remember that A's wouldn't even be at the table to negotiate a deal with since they're all focused on Vegas. What is the point of trying to continue negotiations at that point? Become leverage for John Fisher to get an extra $200 million in Vegas? There's literally no point. Mayor Tao also mentioned that she'd pick up the phone because she still does want the A's in Oakland. She just will only negotiate with them if they negotiate in good faith and not just use Oakland as leverage for a better deal in Vegas. Hansen reiterated this, saying, Just because we removed ourselves as a bargaining chip in Nevada doesn't mean the mayor is not interested in keeping the team in Oakland. Something that had been widely reported was that Mayor Tao had expected a call from Manfred in November 2022 after winning the election, but a call never came. Additionally, something else that was widely reported on was that the A's asked the mayor not to contact Manfred or MLB during the negotiations, as they said they wanted to remain in good faith, which is quite ironic considering how the A's clearly don't know what good faith even means. Now, Manfred and the A's claim to have a different story. During the same interview with the Chronicle, Manfred said he did not hear from Mayor Tao saying, "She wasn't talking to anybody and she sure as hell wasn't talking to me." When asked if Manfred attempted to contact Mayor Tao, he said he hadn't and said he assumed she would call him. However, he said during MLB's annual winter meetings in 2022 that he expected to talk to the newly elected mayor in the near future. The mayor's office once again reiterated the A's asked the mayor not to reach out to Manfred during negotiations, something that John Fisher specifically asked Mayor Tao herself. Without identifying a source, Manfred said that he was told this wasn't true. Not only did Manfred lie about this, but now the A's all of a sudden are claiming this wasn't true either. An A's spokesperson said via email, "The A's did not prevent Mayor Tao or her staff from having conversations with MLB or the commissioner to advance the project. Considering how widely reported this aspect was, why did the A's wait until now to come out and try and deny this? If it weren't true, they would have been denying it months ago because it's been a bad look for the A's all along." Fisher also told Mayor Tao it wouldn't be appropriate to reach out to Manfred unless the deal was completed. Mayor Tao also stated during the Seattle meeting that the city was just $90 million short of the A's latest goal and said that another $65 million was soon on the way. When Manfred was asked about this in the Chronicle interview, he said, "Honestly, if they were that close to the deal, why didn't you throw the $100 million on the table?" Hansen responded to this with, "The city of Oakland was facing a historical deficit of $360 million and simply does not have $100 million sitting in the couch cushions like Mr. Fisher." I mean, seriously, how is a city supposed to instantly come up with $100 million? Cities don't have the same resources of billionaires to just throw $100 million down like that. Remember, though, with the gap as low as $25 million, the limited obligation bond that Oakland proposed would not only cover that remaining $25 million, but it would add an extra $125 million over what was asked. Manfred also cited that the mayor did not have the authority to bind on a proposal, but Hansen once again pointed out that the city council would have voted on a binding agreement during this summer. The only reason this never happened is because the A's decided to run away to Vegas. This all pretty much is a bunch of he said, she said, but with Manfred's history, there is no reason to actually believe anything he says. Plus, the nature of these comments were extremely unprofessional for someone in his position, as he even referred to the mayor as "that woman" at one point. It's apparent that MLB's good old boys club was feeling a little threatened by a female mayor of color. They probably thought they could walk all over her in Oakland and Oakland would beg. Well, they were wrong. It's been great to see Mayor Tao and her staff call out the A's and MLB on their lies. Some may say by doing so, Oakland is hammering the final nail in their coffin in regards to losing the A's, but I disagree, as I don't think this ownership group has ever truly committed to Oakland. No matter what Oakland did, the A's were not going to stay. One thing to expect is that things will only get uglier in this dispute between Oakland and the A's, but let's remember that Oakland has always been incredibly transparent during the entire process, while the A's have always reverted to lying and gaslighting. Meanwhile, higher than the city level, Congresswoman Barbara Lee sent a letter to Rob Manfred requesting him to reconsider his direct involvement in his potential relocation to Las Vegas. Lee argued that Manfred waiving the relocation fee could be perceived as incentivizing the team's relocation, which runs counter to the rationale behind MLB's century-old exemption from antitrust laws. In the past, Manfred has said that the exemption was important for MLB because it helped prevent teams from relocating. A week later, Lee and Congressman Marc Desaulniers introduced the Moneyball Act, which is legislation that would require the owners of any professional baseball team seeking to relocate to compensate the state and local authorities they move away from. If the owners do not oblige, the Major League Baseball would be subject to the antitrust laws they have been exempt from for over a century. This hasn't been the only noise related to baseball's antitrust exemption, as in recent years, Senator Bernie Sanders has also called to an end to MLB's antitrust exemption. And also in June, Republican Senators Mike Lee, Marco Rubio, Ted Cruz, and Josh Hawley introduced a bill that sought to go after the antitrust exemption as well, although their motivations are more sinister, as they are only going after MLB because they don't like the fact that MLB teams host LGBTQ pride nights. So those four are all in the fight for their own reasons. In September, two minor league baseball teams filed a legal challenge against baseball's antitrust exemption, asking the Supreme Court to overturn the exemption. Momentum has been building in recent years in regards to ending MLB's exemption, and one can only hope it's struck down soon by the Supreme Court. Going back to the efforts of A's fans, many A's fans have been reaching out to MLB's 29 other owners to urge them to vote no on relocation. It is realized that it's unlikely many owners will vote no, but the efforts of A's fans shouldn't go unnoticed. Hundreds of letters have already been sent by A's fans so far, pleading with the owners to vote no and giving their reasoning behind why they should. Another thing that has been done was the creation of a website to show that if the A's were sold to an ownership group that committed to Oakland, there would be tons of fans who would instantly commit to buying season tickets. I will provide a link in the description. Perhaps one of the more impressive feats A's fans have accomplished during this period is something that has become known as the Summer of Sell. Through not only social media networking, but also from physically handing out cards such as the ones shown here to fans at games, A's fans have been able to have their sell the team chants appear on the top of the fifth inning in opposing ballparks throughout the season. The first such instance was during the All-Star game on July 11th in Seattle. Conveniently, the Fox Sports broadcast cut to an interview and the crowd noise was all but canceled out, something that was surely intentional as there was knowledge online that it would be happening. Thankfully, fans were able to record video and audio of the chants and it was definitely noticeable. The next such instance was during the Unite the Bay game on July 25th in San Francisco. Many Giants fans were happy to help out A's fans, and sell shirts were handed out before the game, just like they had been on June 13th. During the fifth inning, the fans did not disappoint, as the chants could be very audibly heard during the broadcast. After that series, the A's played in Colorado, where the chants followed them there.
Blue Jays, Padres among those still remaining at the Coliseum this year. Jace Peterson up for a third time. Walked twice against Chris Flexen, who ended up with six walks in 3 2/3 innings. There's a roller behind first base.
Then the chants followed them to Los Angeles.
Scoring their first runs in what seems like forever. So what you hear right now are chants of sell the team as the Summer of Sell continues for Oakland A's fans. They are calling this the reverse boycott everywhere they go. And they are asking fans in every ballpark to join them in support.
And at the start of their next road trip, could be heard again in Washington, D.C. Before their road trip in Washington, D.C., though, the A's stopped home for five games, including two versus the Giants. The August 5th Saturday game versus the Giants was being advertised by some as the unofficial second reverse boycott. Once the A's got wind of this, they jacked up the prices significantly, and the cheapest ticket available for purchase was $44 for the third deck. The A's were, of course, called out for price-gouging fans, but this time it seemed more like a typical money grab by owners and not the A's intentionally trying to turn fans away like during the June 13th game. Of course, the A's would not be donating proceeds to charity this time, though. In total, 37,553 fans attended the game, their biggest crowd of the season, and there had been such a demand for tickets, the A's were forced to sell tickets in sections that had been closed off all season. The sell the team chants were incredibly loud, as expected. All the efforts of A's fans did not go unnoticed during the summer of sell, as many articles were written, with Jeff Passan even saying, "Sell the team was the quote of the year for the 2023 baseball season." Additionally, a documentary known as the Summer of Sell documentary is in the works, chronicling all of the efforts of A's fans in their fight against ownership, and is being produced by Gabriel Colon and Jared Isham. They are currently looking for funding for the project, so I'll add a link in the description for those that would like to help them out. There's also been some talk that Reggie Jackson might file a lawsuit against MLB after he was denied from buying the team in the mid-2000s. It seemed like a sure thing that it was going to happen, but talks have cooled off recently, but it's still something that may be on the horizon in the not-so-distant future. Some other things that we have seen is other fan-sponsored protests, such as these billboards in front of the Coliseum. This one is, of course, directed at John Fisher, but they even have one directed at his mother, Doris. "Doris, get your kid" has become a slogan nearly as popular as "sell the team" amongst A's fans, and you'll also see the phrase both online as well as on signs that can be seen in the right field bleachers. Similar signs also popped up in Sacramento. Additionally, on September 24th, the last home game of the year, a plane flew over and around the Coliseum, carrying a banner that read, "Doris, get your kid, sell the team." These protests definitely weren't cheap, and the A's fans behind them are heroes. Remember how I said earlier that people in Nevada wanted to fight the passing of the A's stadium bill? Well, that process got started when those from the Nevada State Education Association, known as the NSEA, a teachers union, formed a political action committee called Schools Over Stadiums. This PAC was formed to prioritize public education over corporate tax giveaways, with the immediate goal to challenge SB1 any way they could. Many Nevada teachers were furious after many of their needs were not met by Nevada's legislature, as many bills that would have helped Nevada teachers and students were either not passed or were vetoed by Governor Lombardo. Nevada currently ranks 48th in the U.S. in education funding, with the largest class sizes in the country. Nevada also struggles with teacher vacancies, which has left thousands of classrooms with long-term substitutes. This group believes that Nevada's teachers and children should come before giving hundreds of millions to a California billionaire for a stadium, and it's hard to see any flaws in their argument. They're not against Nevada having an MLB team, though, as they believe an expansion team with a privately funded stadium, one that isn't located right on the strip, would be great for Las Vegas. Schools Over Stadiums was interested in pursuing a ballot initiative, referendum, or litigation to stop the funding for SB1. In early September, Schools Over Stadiums filed a referendum petition with the Secretary of State's office. The referendum seeks to repeal a portion of SB1, specifically the section of the bill that relates to the repayment of the $120 million in bonding Clark County is committed through the bill to issuing. They are not going after the $180 million in the bill that would come from the state transferable tax credits, as a development agreement being signed by the A's would make that much harder to go after, something that Steve Hill is likely to rush through so that they cannot come after the $180 million. Hill, who is chairman of the Las Vegas Stadium Authority Board, was recently in the headlines for hiring his own agency, LVCVA, to oversee stadium dealings. Conflict of interest much? The corruption in Vegas and Nevada is off the charts. School Over Stadium spokesperson Alexander Marks said that they could fight the $180 million in court, but said they want to be better stewards of money than Nevada is with public tax dollars. Schools Over Stadiums believes targeting the county bonding component can kneecap the project in its entirety. They believe their referendum is legally sound and has a real shot of getting the signatures needed. Schools Over Stadiums will have until June 26, 2024 to receive 102,362 signatures and submit them to the county clerk to qualify the referendum for the ballot. 25,591 signatures would be needed from each congressional district. Mark stated that they will likely start collecting signatures in October of this year. The referendum is the best shot Nevadans and A's fans have for stopping the stadium scam and from the A's moving to Vegas. It goes without saying, Schools Over Stadiums needs donations to be able to fund the process of receiving the signatures necessary. I know many A's fans and Nevada residents have already donated to their PAC, but if you haven't done so yourself, please consider doing so. In more recent news, Schools Over Stadiums released a statement on September 28th that a lawsuit was filed against them, challenging the referendum petition. The lawsuit was filed by two well-connected lobbyists who have close ties to both the A's and the Las Vegas Stadium Authority. This certainly is a new low for the A's, as suing teachers doesn't exactly scream that they care about the Vegas community. John Fisher is quite literally a cartoon villain at this point. It should come as no surprise that Fisher, known enemy of public schools, is 100% on board with a lawsuit going after teachers. This lawsuit shows that he doesn't care about anyone in Vegas, he just wants his money, and he doesn't want the public to have any say in the A's stadium funding because he knows just how unpopular the bill is in Vegas. However, the public absolutely should have a say considering they're the ones paying for Fisher Stadium. While it's likely the lawsuit will get tossed, the real purpose of the lawsuit, of course, is to try and take time and money away from schools over stadiums. Just showing up to court will already be time and money that gets drained from schools over stadiums, time and money that could have been spent on the referendum petition and getting signatures for it. While yes, it is technically A's lobbyists filing the lawsuit, not the A's themselves, make no mistake, the A's are behind this. When the A's were asked about the lawsuit, they deferred comment to the attorney working on the case, Bradley Schrager. Schrager said he was representing a broad and emerging coalition of businesses and labor interests. When asked if the A's were a part of this coalition, he replied with, yes, of course. So there you have it, the A's are suing teachers. Besides John Fisher and the A's sinking to a new low, this also demonstrates that the referendum petition is scaring the A's to some degree, and that it poses a real threat to the A's plans. As mentioned, this lawsuit's main goal is to financially hamper schools over stadiums, so it's important as ever to donate to them. I will provide a link to their donation page in the description, because this may be the best chance we've got to end the stadium scam and prevent the A's relocation to Vegas. Part 7. Why this happened. I've told the long story of how this happened, but now I'm going to dive into why this happened. There is not a clear answer to this question, but really a multitude of answers, some more relevant than others. There's definitely going to be some speculation here, but there's definitely quite a bit of evidence to support most of these theories. We'll first look at John Fisher, and then we'll look into MLB as a whole, looking into what the intentions and motivations could be for both parties. With John Fisher, there's quite a bit to consider, as you could very well argue he has never had any intention of keeping the A's in Oakland. Of course, there is evidence to support this, as we saw the A's spend the first 10 years of his ownership attempting to move to Fremont and San Jose. Now let's quickly recap the A's stadium interest. There was only one half-baked attempt in Oakland in the first 11 years of Fisher's ownership, but the A's proposal was unrealistic and they began putting all their effort into Fremont literally minutes after the proposal, which suggests they were never serious about the proposal at all. They then spent all their time and effort on Fremont through 2009, followed by 6 years where their sole focus was San Jose. We can't forget about the Coliseum, a site the A's went back and forth on for quite some time. First, they said they would be interested in building there, which was followed by them saying they weren't interested because there would be no ancillary development. Then they went back to being interested due to the parking availability, only to be followed by them not being interested because there wouldn't be enough parking availability, and after some time they eventually considered a backup plan, calling it an assured route to the stadium, till finally saying it was not viable due to there being no ancillary development. Even during the times they were interested in the Coliseum site, they never made any attempts to do anything about it until they purchased Alameda County's half of the site in 2019, but we all know what they said about the site just a short time after that. The Peralta site being chosen was another half-baked attempt in 2017, as the A's announced the plans before even consulting the College Board. Then in late 2018, they decided on Howard Terminal, something they'd said no to for 17 years, something A's ownership had been 100% against and had called it impossible to build there. Regardless, they chose the site, had an unrealistic timeline, missed deadlines, asked for extensions, were delayed by the pandemic and lawsuits, blamed Oakland for things moving slowly, started putting more efforts into Vegas and Oakland in 2021, called it Howard Terminal or bust, and then backed out and ran away to Vegas when the deal was close to being done in Oakland. One theory that has been rapidly gaining traction is that Fisher simply cannot afford the Howard Terminal deal. Whether he knew that he couldn't afford this all along, or if things changed due to the pandemic and inflation, remains to be seen, but there is some evidence out there that Fisher is cash poor. In 2020, Fisher put up both the A's and Earthquakes as collateral for 5-year loans. Gap stocks have also been in the toilet, trending downwards for quite some time, many Gap stores have been closing, and the company has been laying off workers in large amounts to try and slash their operating expenses. Of course, there is also the fact that he couldn't secure a stadium deal unless nearly $400 million in public funds was given to him, a deal that we know is far less lucrative than the Howard Terminal project. Also, there is the waived relocation fee, which according to inside sources was done because Fisher could not afford the stadium project otherwise. Lastly, it's been very evident that Fisher is struggling to finance the ballpark in Vegas. Could the Howard Terminal project have fallen apart for Fisher because investors got cold feet? Did the costs of the project skyrocket too much due to inflation? Was Fisher ever going to be able to afford the costs? Did he even want to pay for the costs in the first place? We don't know for sure, but we do know three things. Money is the most important thing for Fisher. Fisher has taken a hit to some degree financially. And Fisher is the one who backed out of the negotiations when a deal with Oakland was close. probably a scenario where there's not one clear answer and likely a combination of several things, but it is clear that if Fisher did ever want Howard Terminal to actually happen, he didn't want it that badly or he would have seen things through. If the project had been completed, he could have made an enormous profit, but maybe he's not smart enough to see that. Something else many have theorized is that Fisher will do a pump-and-dump scheme in which he will sell the team as soon as they break ground for the ballpark in Vegas. The new ballpark would likely double the team's valuation, leading to a very large profit for Fisher. He has denied this, of course, saying he got into the game because he wants to win, but all evidence seems to suggest he only cares about the money and couldn't care less about the on-the-field product. He also may have just wanted the largest handout possible, and while Vegas's handout is less than the money Oakland raised, the project in Vegas is obviously considerably smaller, so the amount of money that Vegas was willing to fork over would cover a significantly higher percentage of the project. Of course, if all that Fisher asked for was for a 9-acre stadium in Oakland, he could have had one built years ago. Fisher only wanted the most complex project possible in Oakland, and that is something that was likely intentionally done. Now let's examine some other possibilities of why Fisher chose to abandon Oakland. Some think it could be politically motivated for Fisher, as he is a known conservative, and conservatives seem to focus a lot of energy hitting on both California and Oakland these days. In Fisher's case, it would probably more so be the purpose of leaving Oakland, considering he is a California native who has lived most of his life here. Perhaps he wants nothing to do with a left-leaning city that is also one of the most diverse in the nation. This is all purely speculation, of course, and I don't think it's his main reason behind his abandonment of the city, but it's been brought up as a possible reason enough that it's certainly worth mentioning, as it could be a contributing factor towards the decision. Another theory is that he is just helping MLB accomplish what they have long set out to do. This could entail a number of things, ranging from looking into and testing the viability of the Vegas market, to force-feeding Vegas a team so MLB can get more involved in gambling, which is something that is reported to be on the horizon for the league, to helping create a realistic threat of relocation for owners to have in their back pocket when they're attempting to extort hundreds of millions of tax dollars from their cities, to helping MLB and team owners from getting the league out of one of the most diverse and left-leaning cities, or to ensure that the Bay Area becomes a one-team market, which would greatly benefit the Giants. Some or all of the aforementioned possibilities could explain MLB's interest in tearing the A's away from Oakland. MLB has been interested in the Vegas market since the 90s, and it is no secret MLB wants to get more involved in gambling, so both these reasons could explain why the league wants to force this move to Vegas. Fisher's reward for helping MLB accomplish this would be larger revenue sharing checks, as well as the assurance he would stay on revenue sharing. To help him with this, MLB has already waived the relocation fee, discredited Oakland, and has defended Fisher at every turn. On the chance that the reasoning is political, Oakland is, by the American standard, a left-leaning city. It is also one of the most diverse cities in the entire U.S. MLB, while they act like they care about diversity and inclusion, really don't, because if they really did care, they wouldn't be trying to steal the A's away from such a diverse city. MLB owners, of course, are mostly a bunch of conservative billionaires. As I've said earlier, I'm trying to mostly leave partisan politics out of this video, but it's something we still have to consider. As mentioned earlier, conservatives generally don't like California, especially Oakland, so it's possible this could be politically motivated. Considering that the media is extremely biased against Oakland, it would be easy for the league to blame Oakland for losing the A's, knowing a good portion of the U.S. will blindly agree with them. One of the more prominent theories is that MLB wants the Bay Area to only have one team again, and they want the Giants to have the entire Bay Area market. MLB has been saying that it was a mistake to have two teams in the Bay Area market since the mid-1970s, and since that point, both the A's and the Giants have flirted with relocation out of the Bay Area for quite some time. Thankfully for Giants fans, those talks ended in the early 1990s, but the relocation threat has always remained for A's fans, other than for a brief period, which was the length of Walter Haas' ownership. We also know MLB still maintained their belief of the Bay Area being a one-team market as late as the 2000s, as Bud Selig let everyone know multiple times what he and MLB thought of the A's also being in the Bay Area market. Recently, Giants attendance has been noticeably lower than what it once was, so perhaps there is a renewed interest in removing the A's from the market, or perhaps maybe MLB is just finally going forward with what it has wanted to do all along. In 2018, Manfred had said, "I believe there is not another market in the United States that has the upside potential that Oakland has, and I think we would regret leaving Oakland if we did that." While he is right about the upside, his desire to take the A's out of Oakland makes you think he didn't mean at all what he said. One may wonder, why would the owners support someone like Fisher, someone who is making the league and other owners look terrible in the eye of public perception? Also, what's notable is that they are losing out on the rewards from a relocation fee since Manfred has waived it for the A's. If the A's build a new stadium in Oakland, especially at Howard Terminal, and Vegas received an expansion team, that would be the absolute best-case scenario for both markets and for MLB in general. An expansion fee could be as much as $2.2 billion, something MLB owners would be able to divide amongst themselves, and the A's prosper a new ballpark in Oakland and an expansion team, prospering in a privately financed ballpark in Vegas would have everyone happy, and tons of money would be made in the process. It makes no sense to pass all of that up by not going with an expansion team in Vegas, taking a team away from its community in the 10th largest media market, all while letting Fisher stay on revenue sharing and forking over more cash to him than ever before due to being in Vegas' small TV market. Why would the owners want to keep sharing their profits with him while the waived relocation fee and lack of expansion fee also limited their profits? There are two main reasons why the owners support this sort of behavior. For one, billionaires protect their fellow billionaires. The great George Carlin once said, referring to the billionaires of this country, "It's a big club and you ain't in it." It's pretty self-explanatory. The other reason why owners support this kind of behavior is because of the kind of leverage it would give them against the city their team is currently in. This brings us to what perhaps may be the main reason MLB and team owners want this move to happen. Leverage. All the owners want more leverage in negotiations. Billionaires hate socialism and they hate taxes of any kind, but when it comes to their teams and their stadiums, though, they love the idea. Nearly every owner salivates over the idea of extorting hundreds of millions of dollars, if not $1 billion, from the city their team is located in. Whether it's for a new stadium or just stadium improvements, owners never want the money to come out of their pocket, and they don't want to use the profit that their teams produce either, because that is for their own pockets. Team owners, owners like John Fisher, have always used the threat of relocation if they don't get what they want from their team's city. There are currently several teams who are looking for new stadiums or upgrades to their current stadiums. If the A's relocation passes, that threat of relocation suddenly looks very real. Make no mistake, this is the main reason MLB wants this move to happen and why the owners will vote yes. It stands to benefit them tremendously, as it is very helpful in the path towards extorting hundreds of millions from their cities and their team's valuation and their net worth skyrocketing. To say they are giddy over the idea of this happening would be an understatement. Recently, many teams have been in the headlines over their demands for new stadiums and upgrades to stadiums that are only 2 decades old. Some of these owners are even leaking to the press that relocation is possible. The Brewers and Diamondbacks are amongst teams that seek improvements to their stadiums, with the Brewers and MLB threatening relocation, and the Diamondbacks considering a new stadium entirely. Meanwhile, Jerry Reisendorf, owner of the White Sox, is also hinting at a relocation at the end of the team's lease at Guaranteed Rate Field. The Kansas City Royals also want a new stadium, which they want $1 billion in public funds for, and Baltimore Orioles owner John Angelos was crying about needing $900 million for stadium upgrades for Camden Yards. The Tampa Bay Rays also want a new stadium, and the threat of relocation has always been there for them, and like the A's, lived through threats of contraction as well. The Los Angeles Angels have also been a team seeking a new ballpark or stadium upgrades, and have been exploring stadiums outside of Anaheim as well, and it's been hinted that relocation could be an option for them down the road as well. Considering that stadiums aren't even lasting 20 years before these owners want massive upgrades, and prior to year 30, these owners want a new stadium entirely, there will constantly be MLB owners seeking more and more money until the end of time. As things progress for the A's relocation to Vegas, we saw Baltimore agree to give $600 million to the Orioles, although Angelos remains insistent on receiving $900 million. We also saw Republicans in Wisconsin introduce a $700 million bill that would go towards upgrades for American Family Field, the Brewers Stadium, and we also saw the Rays announce a new ballpark plan, a plan in which they would receive $600 million from public contribution. It is no coincidence these deals are popping up all of a sudden, as cities are growing worried over relocation threats. Cities don't want what happened in Oakland to happen to them. MLB's newest threat appears to be the Nashville market, and cities are definitely feeling the pressure of potentially losing their team to there. This kind of behavior from MLB and team owners is exactly why this antitrust exemption needs to be struck down. At the end of the day, there are a number of reasons why the A's and MLB want to leave Oakland for Vegas. It could be politically motivated for Fisher, but at the end of the day, the major two reasons have to do with money and with Fisher never having a desire to keep the A's in Oakland. In terms of money, it's either Fisher did not have enough to finance the project, or he wasn't willing to spend it, or he wanted the biggest handout relative to the size of the project. For MLB, it's either the desire for a one-team market and to help the Giants, politics, desire to enter the Vegas market and or get involved in gambling, but mostly I believe it is about billionaire welfare for MLB owners. It always comes down to money. Above all else, it's apparent to me Fisher has never had a serious interest in remaining in Oakland, as there has never been a truly genuine effort to stay. This is why Oakland is losing its baseball team, not because of A's fans, not because of the city of Oakland, but because of John Fisher and MLB. Part 8, What Lies Ahead. We've spent a great deal of time talking about what has happened, and we also touched on why it happened. So let's discuss what lies ahead. Two things that will happen soon is the referendum petition in Nevada will start getting signatures, likely in October, and the owners will vote on the A's relocation, likely in mid-November. It is, of course, expected they will vote yes, despite the A's not having secured funding for the project, not having chosen an architect for the project, not having any real renderings of the ballpark, not knowing if the stadium will have a dome or a retractable roof, not having secured a TV deal, not having any corporate sponsors, and not having settled where the A's will play during construction. As for the referendum, if it were to get enough signatures, it would appear on the ballot in November 2024, and it would be up to Nevada voters to decide if they were okay with giving John Fisher hundreds of millions for a stadium or not. In theory, if the relocation progress continues for the A's, the Tropicana will probably close near the end of 2024, possibly as late as May 2025. In the meantime, the A's do not have a secured home beyond 2024. The Coliseum lease ends at the end of the 2024 season, and the absolute earliest a ballpark in Vegas would be ready is 2028. That leaves at least 3 years with the A's not having a place to play. As mentioned earlier, the three main options are a Coliseum lease extension, splitting Oracle Park with the Giants, or playing at Las Vegas Ballpark, home of the Aviators, which I can't imagine would be very popular with the MLB Players Association considering the extreme heat, and it wouldn't be very popular with the A's or MLB due to the fact that the ballpark is not even close to being suitable to even be a temporary home for an MLB team. There, of course, is also a distant fourth option, which is them playing somewhere else, whether that be somewhere like Reno, Sacramento, or some other place. There is no clear-cut answer yet, and probably won't be until 2024. I'd imagine that Oakland will use their leverage and will not extend the Coliseum lease unless one of three things happen. The first would be if the Vegas deal falls through and the A's are either back to square one with their ballpark situation, or they decide to re-enter talks for the Howard Terminal project. The second would be if MLB and the A's agreed to leave the A's name, colors, and logo behind in Oakland, as well as an agreement that an Oakland expansion team would retain the A's records if such a thing were to ever happen. The third thing would be if a lease extension came with the stipulation that Oakland received an expansion team, which I do not think is very likely. While yes, it has been leaked that if an Oakland ownership group emerged and proved they could finish off the Howard Terminal deal with Oakland, that Oakland would be right up there with Nashville for the two most likely cities to receive an expansion team, it still will never happen. There are several reasons for this. One, it would make no sense for MLB to let themselves and the A's to get dragged through the mud by the press due to the A's relocation, only to end up giving Oakland an expansion team. A much easier solution would have been to make it work for the A's in Oakland and give Vegas an expansion team. It would have been way less of a headache to do this, and a new ballpark would prosper in Oakland, and an expansion team would probably do pretty well in Vegas, especially if it was headed by a local ownership group that was willing to privately finance the stadium, like the owners of the Golden Knights. Although they'd never admit it, MLB knows this, and considering that it's not happening that way, it should be pretty evident that MLB wants to be done with Oakland for good. Also, MLB wants to stick up for their fellow billionaire, and giving Oakland an expansion team would just be admitting that John Fisher was a failure since he couldn't make it work in Oakland. While John Fisher is indeed a failure, I expect MLB to double down and to try to keep all the blame on Oakland. Of course, MLB and the owners are also salivating at the thought of being able to use Oakland losing the A's as proof that a relocation threat is very real during negotiations with cities that aren't bending over backwards and letting billionaires extort them. Giving Oakland an expansion team would greatly lessen that threat. Additionally, the Giants would finally have the market to themselves, something MLB has wanted all along, so I don't see the league adding a second team back to the market ever again. It's also worth noting that MLB is probably fuming that not only Oakland is not bending over for MLB, but also that Oakland and A's fans have exposed John Fisher, the A's, Rob Manfred, and MLB for who they really are. It's been an avalanche of bad PR for all those parties, which I'm sure has infuriated them all, and they will probably hold a grudge for it. The real reason this expansion lie was floated out there was to get A's fans, who've done a tremendous job fighting to keep their team, defending their city, and exposing the lies and corruption, to back off. Well, A's fans, don't fall for the trick. Don't fall for the hope. I feel like I don't need to say this, because A's fans never lay down and quit, but keep fighting. Do not be lured with false promises. We have seen time and time again how that plays out. Another loose end that would need tied up is the future of the Coliseum site, which, as mentioned earlier, John Fisher owns 50% of. A black-owned Oakland development group known as the African American Sports and Entertainment Group has been engaged with the City of Oakland to redevelop the Coliseum site since 2021. This only began after the A's said the Coliseum site wasn't viable for a new ballpark. The group has plans of using the 155-acre Coliseum complex and redeveloping it for both retail and nightlife, and even possibly to try and get a WNBA team, although the latter appears far less likely now to recent reports that Golden State Warriors owners are close to bringing a WNBA expansion team to the Bay Area that would play at Chase Center. Still, Oakland officials predict that the redevelopment of the complex would bring as many as 30,000 jobs to the area. Many say it would revitalize that section of Oakland and it would create a second downtown. Just recently, Fisher rejected an offer from the group for the land. Dave Cavill says the A's have no plan to sell the land either. So not only are the A's leaving Oakland after walking away from the Howard Terminal deal and saying the Coliseum site isn't viable, but they are blocking the area from being redeveloped. It really seems like Fisher is doing this at this point because he is either spiteful or he just straight up hates Oakland. Something that may also be on the horizon is potential lawsuits. It is believed by some that Oakland could win hundreds of millions in a potential lawsuit. In 2021, the Los Angeles Rams, formerly of St. Louis, reached a settlement to end a lawsuit that was filed in 2017 by St. Louis over the team's relocation to Los Angeles. In the settlement, Rams owner Stan Kroenke was to pay $790 million to the city of St. Louis. It remains a possibility that Oakland could hit Fisher and the A's with a similar lawsuit, although knowing Fisher, I'm sure he'd rather fight it in court for a decade before even considering settling. If the A's do follow through and leave, one hopes that Oakland will sue the A's and Fisher for all that they're worth. Lastly, it should be noted that the funds raised by Oakland for the Howard Terminal Ballpark and redevelopment will not go towards nothing, as they will at least be able to use the funds to help clean up the area and redevelop it. I'm sure everyone would have preferred the A's have a ballpark there, but at the very least, Oakland will be able to redevelop the Howard Terminal area, which is an area with a lot of potential. The future may be bleak for the A's staying in Oakland, but we will hold on to hope that this will somehow all fall apart for Fisher, and they'll be forced to sell the team to an owner who will build the A's a new ballpark in Oakland, but A's fans never have had luck on their side. Part 9. Correcting the Narrative. Something that we as Oakland A's fans can do and need to do is correct the narrative. The narrative that it's the fault of A's fans and the city of Oakland needs to be disproven at every turn. The problem has always been, is, and always will be A's owners, and I hope this video has helped demonstrate that. You absolutely cannot blame fans for not showing up when the team is never sincerely committed to staying in Oakland, never committed to the community, never committed to the players, and never committed to winning, all while treating their fans, their players, their employees, their city, and everyone else around them like dirt. It should be known to everyone that Oakland has done every possible thing to try and keep our team, and it's the owners who have never put in a sincere effort to keep the team here. Oakland already gets unfairly portrayed by the biased media, as any minor shortcoming of the city and any crime that occurs in the city are thrown into the spotlight for everyone to jump on and attack. Despite online trolls who love to fearmonger wanting you to believe Oakland is the most dangerous city in the US, it actually isn't, and it's not even close. While it is true that Oakland's violent crime rate per 1,000 citizens is double the national average, it should also be noted that Oakland only ranks 40th in the US in violent crime rate per 1,000 citizens. Every big city has crime, and there are dozens of large cities ranking higher on the list than Oakland, but no city receives negative attention to the degree that Oakland does. There are tons of people out there that want to see Oakland fail, so we can't let the narrative of Oakland failing the A's win, because it simply isn't true. Oakland is one of the most diverse and unique cities in the entire country, the rich cultural scene, and it has an abundance of natural beauty. Whether it's the views of the bay, the hills, the open space, or its many parks, and the weather there is phenomenal. We cannot continue to allow for everyone to dump on our great city. The narrative has to change, and part of that narrative is telling the true story of why the A's left Oakland. Also, anytime you hear the Oakland lost three teams in 5 years argument, remind them that John Fisher is the sole reason for the A's leaving Oakland and that he played a very large hand in the Raiders leaving. Don't believe me? Mark Davis has said it himself. As for the Warriors, their name since 1971 has been the Golden State Warriors, and they were named this because they planned to split their games between Oakland and San Diego. While that split only lasted for one season, the name stuck, and they were never the Oakland Warriors. They simply moved their arena from one city to another, and the city, San Francisco, has double the population, with their arena's location being a waterfront property. It was purely a business decision, and the team has never harbored any ill will towards Oakland. In fact, the Warriors routinely wear jerseys that honor their time in Oakland. Besides, the Warriors were in San Francisco before Oakland anyways, and it's not like they changed their name to the San Francisco Warriors, which is their name prior to 1971. Things may appear bleak in regards to the A's chances of remaining in Oakland, but the fight is far from over. There are still things we can all do to fight back. For one, we can keep shining a light on everything John Fisher, the A's, and MLB have done. Their actions speak for themselves, and calling out all their wrongdoings every chance we get and keeping them trending in the news will continue to put pressure on them, and it will keep the discussion going and continue to raise more awareness as to what they have done. We are in the age of social media. Let's use it to our advantage. We can also continue to contact the owners, as while it's unlikely a single letter or thousands of letters would change their minds, we should at least let them know that we see this all for what it really is, and that if any of them had an ounce of integrity, they'd vote no on relocation. We'll also show them just how unpopular this proposed relocation is. We should remind them that MLB will forever lose hundreds of thousands of customers from the 10th largest media market if this relocation goes through. It also may be worth looking into any legal actions that we could pursue against the A's and MLB. Even if we can't stop the relocation, it'd be nice to take a nice chunk of change out of their wallets. One of the best things we can do is help schools over stadiums with their referendum petition. Whether that is donating to them, signing the petition if you're a Nevada resident, or just contacting them to see how you can help, they would greatly appreciate it and it would help them immensely. It is the best shot we have of destroying the stadium deal in Nevada, which would create an enormous roadblock for the A's relocation plans. All in all, the death of baseball in Oakland was caused by John Fisher and several other terrible owners, and these owners were all aided by MLB's corruption. It's a crime that John Fisher is on the verge of robbing our community of our team, and MLB is equally complicit for allowing this to happen. A's fans in the city of Oakland don't deserve this, and they certainly don't deserve any blame either. Please, even if you're not an A's fan, do your part and speak up for A's fans in the city of Oakland. Don't let the narrative blaming the fans in the city win. Do your part to call out A's owners and MLB at every turn, and fight back in any way that you can. My sincere hope is that this video becomes pointless one day, and that the Vegas deal falls apart, Fisher sells the team, and the A's remain in Oakland forever. Not every story has a happy ending, though. I know making this video won't stop the A's from leaving or anything crazy like that, but I do hope this video at least demonstrated that A's fans are not to blame for anything, and neither is the city of Oakland, who has worked tirelessly for years to try and keep the A's, and that the A's potential relocation is 100% on John Fisher and Major League Baseball. Keep fighting, A's fans. Oakland forever. Thank you for watching.